We'll start with our Mediterranean Forum. Since the last forum, which took place in Palermo last year, we all remember, many of us have stayed very busy working with the partner countries. I think we can be proud of our work since then, and especially the debate we had on Mediterranean events during the winter meeting in Vienna, the discussions and outcome of the Belgrade annual session should also be underlined. The Assembly is currently engaging with Tunisia, as we got opportunity to hear this morning from our Vice President, Signor Migliori. And our engagement in Tunisia is in a way that has never been done before, namely by sending a full observation mission in our partner country for the elections, which will be held Sunday in 2 weeks from today. Being myself a Croatian by nationality and Mediterranean by heart, I attach great importance to today's topic. We know it's making a Mediterranean a safer place, creating an area of freedom, security, and justice. And I welcome the participants from Mediterranean partner countries who will be given the floor in a moment, as well as our distinguished speakers here at the podium. I welcome very much. But a couple of the sentences before. The wave of shock started by Mohamed Bouazizi setting himself on fire in Tunisia on 7 December 2010 is continuing to change the world. Its global consequences are in a way comparable to the fall of the communism 20 years ago. The slogans that have been spreading from Tunisia over Egypt all the way to Bahrain were not either nationalistic or religious. Jobs, education, better income, and democratic rights are the main requests of the Arab Spring. Like after every political earthquake, there are far many questions than answers. Here, we are talking about the third large reset of international relations in the last 20 years, after pulling down the communist system in Central and Eastern Europe, and after a terrorist attack on the United States of America on September 11, 2001. I shall give soon the floor to Ambassador Zanier, the OSCE Secretary General, to be followed by Ambassador Leary, or Ireland, and Mr. Predrag Matveevich. But it's my pleasure to give the floor first to our President for some introductory remarks. Petros, please, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Tonino. And it is obvious that maybe it's not only a new era for the world, but maybe it's a new challenge for the OSCE that this Mediterranean Forum, maybe we hope that in the future will be transformed to the OSCE dimension in Mediterranean. So let's speak with our mind, but also by our hearts. Dear colleagues and representatives from the Mediterranean partner states, it is a pleasure again to see the delegation from Algeria, Israel, Jordan, Morocco, and Tunisia being with us. We salute you for your active participation in this forum and our assembly at large. Our body is a stronger one because of your involvement. You will hold this event each fall, the Mediterranean Forum, and this year I know and we all know very well the current state of democracy and stability in this region is on all of our minds, but for a moment, let's outlive the present. Think about where you were when you were 26. I was 26. I was teaching Greek to secondary students, working as a journalist, and tried to develop a political movement in my country. But let's go to the name that Tonino Picula just a few minutes before mentioned. When Mohamed Bouazizi was 26, he was selling vegetables at the street as a street vendor in Tunisia. Most of his life was still ahead of him, but he had lost hope. How can one hope for change when since he was 3 years old, his country had been ruled by one man? How can one hope for a fair and just future when since he was a teen, he had known nothing but government harassment for just trying to make a living selling fruits and vegetables? So he lost hope. And when he set his body afire, it sparked a transformation in millions of people across the Mediterranean region who also had tired of tyrants and dreamed of democracy. We are with that people. We are with all those that have this thirst of democracy for their own lives and to shape their own destiny. This meeting is about creating an area of freedom, security and justice in the Mediterranean, which is all Mohamed Bouazizi has wanted, which is all any of us want. The security to know we won't be harassed for a bribe, and justice that in the end says we live under the rule of law and not rulers. In the end, we all want what the OSCE was created to protect. But too often, organizations like ours feel we need to wait to act, wait for the invitation, wait until they call for help. Sometimes there is the presumption that people in the Arab world do not want our help, and our assembly has rightly voted that the OSCE should only assist when we are asked to do so. But if we always wait for the call for help, then we assume transitional leaders know about us and what we can offer. But I believe that most of the people who took to the streets in Tunis and Cairo and Benghazi in the past 9 months have never heard of the OSCE. We know their story. Now we must tell our story to them. After all, with Tunisia and Egypt already scheduling election, and protesters aiming to turn their passion into functioning political parties, who better than us, elected parliamentarians, to meet with them and support a precedent-setting fair electoral process? We are a tool in the worksheet for democracy which we all have been called upon to build. We are still hammering away at creating Europe whole and free. We are not there yet, but we remain committed to that goal for as long it takes to ensure basic rights and enjoyed by all citizens, not just from Vancouver to Vladivostok, but from Tromso to Tunis, the Arctic to Africa. I'm pleased to see more North-South Mediterranean cooperation occurring today, not just in forums like this, but in the field. Twice in the past month, as we know well from our session in the morning, Vice President Migliori of Italy has been in Tunisia to visit with election officials, civil society and media to support the democratic growth and prepare for our upcoming election observation mission. The strong interest from our members to observe this historic vote is a tangible sign of our willingness to partner with new leaders in the region toward our common goals. On freedom of expression, that means embracing new online technologies and turning away from a past of internet repression. On security, that means continuing bilateral, bilateral dialogue. With a region in flux, it is critical that diplomats maintain their communication and parliamentarians maintain their relations. OSCE security work in the southern Mediterranean should be based on international cooperation aimed at eliminating the social and economic causes of instability, reinforcing democratization and restoring an intercultural dialogue. It is widely recognized that huge disparities of wealth and environmental resources between the countries of the northern and southern shores of the Mediterranean can destabilize the region. Poverty breeds resentment and alienation, fueling support for radical movements. The Mediterranean region is in a special place with its own unique dynamics and security challenges. Therefore, the OSCE model, our model, of cooperative security can be proposed to, but not imposed upon the region. I look forward to our discussion today about how we can promote this cooperation on an equal base and be a partner for progress in the region about which we all care so much and we are committed to work for that. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Petras. Now I'd like to proceed with the agenda and I'll give the floor to Ambassador Lamberto Zanier, the Secretary General of our organization. Please, sir.
Thank you very much, Vice President Pizzula and President FTMU for inviting me to address this topic. An area to which, as you will see in a moment, the OSCE is paying special attention, particularly in this moment. My remarks will focus on four areas. Why the OSCE is well placed to contribute to making the Mediterranean a safer place, the conditions and the modalities for an OSCE engagement, what has been done so far, and then next steps and the potential role of the parliamentarians in this context. Now, in general, there are two main reasons why the OSCE could be an ideal partner for countries in the southern Mediterranean in their transition to democracy, and this is beyond the obvious consideration that the Mediterranean dossier has been on the agenda of the organization since the inception of the CSCE. The first is that we have both an effective venue for dialogue and a flexible mechanism for implementation. The Mediterranean Contact Group, capably chaired this year by Ambassador O'Leary, provides a regular forum for exchanging information, views, and ideas, as well as for fostering our mutual knowledge and trust. And the Partnership Fund provides us with a flexible tool for implementing concrete follow-up joint cooperation projects. Second point is that the OSCE's inclusive membership, which represents a broad range of experiences and approaches to democratic transformation, includes long-established democracies and countries with recent experience of democratic reform. It includes diverse cultures, including many societies with Muslim majorities. The OSCE has developed a flexible set of tools to assist this diverse community with the challenges of comprehensive security and democratic transition. Partners may find this experience and this toolbox interesting also for their own processes. Looking at the conditions and modalities for a contribution, however, for the OSCE to be activated, three basic conditions need to be met. First, a clear request should be received from the partner state. We need to not to forget the fact that Mediterranean partners are, in fact, our partners. They are not really member states of the organization. So they are welcome to working with this organization, but obviously the rule is that any activity addressing issues of interest to them has to be developed on the basis of a manifestation of interest on their side. Secondly, a consensus decision by participating states. That would have to be taken for the implementation of any activity outside the OSCE area, as we have defined it. The third point is that adequate extra-budgetary resources would need to be made available to fund these activities. With these caveats, let me reiterate that the OSCE has always kept and will continue to keep its door open to the partners, sharing its experience through joint projects and initiatives, and supporting enhanced participation by representatives from the partners in OSCE activities. Now, looking at what we've done so far, last December in Astana, OSCE heads of state and government acknowledged once more that the security of the OSCE region is inextricably linked to security in the Mediterranean region. And they also agreed in that context to enhance the level of cooperation with our partners. The events that have unfolded since then have opened up new opportunities for such operation, even as they have highlighted its importance. In the dialogue initiated with Tunisia, Morocco, and Egypt, also through a number of visits in various formats to the region, each country has expressed interest in the OSCE toolbox. But it is clear that each country is unique in its culture, in its priorities, and in the path that it chooses to take. Nevertheless, a number of common areas where OSCE experience could provide added value have been identified, and possible initiatives in these areas have been discussed with partners. These include support to building democratic institutions, election support, media freedom, police reform, good governance, and fighting corruption. But of course, concrete activities will have to be designed together with each partner country, to the extent that this partner country is interested in doing that, as I said. I'm personally committed to facilitating a continuous and an open dialogue with partner countries, as I did on the occasion of my recent visit to Cairo on 5th and 6th of September, when I met with government officials and civil society actors. During that visit, I also had a very constructive meeting with the new Secretary General of the League of the Arab States, Ambassador Nabil El Arabi. I'm convinced of the value of cooperation with regional organizations to assure efficiency and ownership, and I'm committed with this approach. With Ambassador El Arabi, for instance, we discussed issues, and this was his initiative more than mine, issues of stepping up the degree of cooperation between the two organizations. He expressed to me interest coming to Vienna and addressing the Permanent Council, which I conveyed to the chair. The chair invited him, and he now gave a favorable answer to that invitation. So we're looking at the date now when he could come and address the Permanent Council, and this in itself would also help put the Mediterranean issue more firmly on the agenda of the organization. So, as I said, relations and strong interaction with regional and other interested organizations. I was recently in New York for the General Assembly, and they discussed this issue with many actors. For instance, with high officials of the EU External Action Service, with the chair and with the Secretary General of the Organization for Islamic Cooperation, with President Sampaio, with whom we touched upon the role of the Alliance of Civilizations. There are many different initiatives and organizations that can play a useful role, and connections have to be kept open between them. Following requests expressed by civil society representatives on the occasion of our visit to the region, ODIHR organized at the end of July a training on methodologies of human rights and election monitoring for Egyptian NGOs. We got a feedback from the participants to this training, feedback which was overall positive, but with some suggestions to adjust a couple of things or to focus better on certain areas. And the office is now organizing a training domestic election observation from further NGOs from Egypt and from NGOs from Morocco and Tunisia to take place in a few days' time in Budva. So there is an expectation that this issue, the Mediterranean issue, may feature prominently also on the agenda of the Ministerial Council in Vilnius. I have personally delivered, when I was in New York, an invitation on behalf of the chairmanship to the UN Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. But for this event in Vilnius to have an impact, it will be important also that partners engage, and my view is that it would be important for them to be represented at ministerial level. Now, looking ahead, the Mediterranean conference that will start tomorrow in Budva provides a good opportunity for exchanging views and generating ideas on the way forward. We have learned from our own experience that democratic transitions are long-term processes, which can suffer from delays and from setbacks, and each of them is unique. Progress requires the joint effort of all sectors of society and the continued support of the international community, but local internal ownership by the countries is an essential condition for this process to be successful. And that's something that the OSCE, I think, has understood, has learned, and is respecting. Now, for the OSCE's potential contribution to be fully appreciated on the southern shore of the Mediterranean, we need to make our organization better known and to engage with all facets of the society. And this is where you, as parliamentarians, can play a useful role in supporting this organization. Through your daily contacts with your own constituents, your parliamentary colleagues, the media, and with your governments, you can play an important role in building awareness of the OSCE's values, of the usefulness of the OSCE experience, and of the relevance of this experience also for other countries that go through difficult transition processes. And I'm looking forward to perhaps discussing further of these points with you. I'll leave it at this. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Secretary General. Now I'll pass the floor to Ambassador O'Leary, Ambassador of Ireland to OSCE and Chairman of the OSCE Contact Group with the Mediterranean Partners for Cooperation. Ambassador, you got the floor.
Thank you, Vice President, President Eftimio. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for inviting me here today, and particular thanks to our Croatian hosts for what has been a wonderful event and wonderful hospitality. 2011 is a year that is destined to be a milestone in the history of the Arab world. It is the year when people power became the reality on the streets of Tunis and Cairo. It is a year in which their actions demonstrated to us that the desire to live in free and democratic societies governed by the rule of law and respect for human rights is not just a prerogative of the developed world. The goals and ambitions of the people for their countries mirror in so many ways the vision of the authors of the Helsinki Final Act, who put respect for human rights and fundamental freedoms, together with equal rights and self-determination of peoples, at the centre of the Helsinki Decalogue. Inspired by these dramatic events, other countries in the region have undertaken fundamental reforms. We in the OSCE have witnessed once before such a transformative wave. We look back to the momentous events of 1989 and the exciting developments of the early 1990s that ushered in democratic values throughout Central and Eastern Europe. This was a seminal period in the history of the OSCE, giving us the legacy of the Charter of Paris for a New Europe and the definitive human dimension texts of the Copenhagen and Moscow documents. The OSCE, therefore, has much to offer our Mediterranean partners, and Secretary General Zannier, in his presentation just now, has summarized the active, engaged response of the organization and its institutions, especially ODIHR, to the events of the Arab Spring. He has also detailed some of the ways in which the OSCE could assist the countries of the Mediterranean region in their transition to democracy. It is not my intention to cover this same ground, but rather to inform you of the work of the contact group with the Mediterranean Partners for Cooperation, which I have had the honour to chair this year. Our starting point was the Astana Commemorative Declaration, which recognised that the security of the OSCE area was inextricably linked to that of adjacent areas, notably in the Mediterranean and in Asia, and stated that we must therefore enhance the level of our interaction with the Partners for Cooperation. The key elements of any true partnership, equality and mutual respect, have continued to be critical to the work of the group. And our approach from the beginning has been to involve the partners fully in the organization of the group. The contact group meetings have been addressed by a series of distinguished speakers, including the chairs of the three OSCE committees, the director of ODIHR, the coordinator of the economic and environmental activities, and the new director of the Conflict Prevention Center. As is traditional, we have also invited the special representative of the Parliamentary Assembly in Vienna, Ambassador Notella, to brief the group on the outcome of the Parliamentary Assembly's annual session in Belgrade in July. We have also had speakers from the Council of Europe, NATO, and the League of Arab States. Partnership, of course, is a give-and-take process. In practical terms, this meant that we did not confine our agendas to a series of expert presentations, but aimed for a true dialogue, one in which the partners and the participating states made a full contribution. This became all the more important as the events of the Arab Spring unfolded before our eyes. We were privileged to be briefed on developments in their states by the representatives of Algeria, Egypt, Jordan, Morocco, and Tunisia. These presentations, which focused particularly on national reform programs, were major highlights of the contact group meetings during the year. These meetings attracted very high levels of attendance from the ambassadors of both the partner states and the participating states. We also sought to bring some tangible, practical measures into effect. We have promoted, for example, the Junior Professional Officer Programme for the placement of young professionals from the Mediterranean region in the Secretariat and the institutions. We have also secured agreement in the Permanent Council for a project in the area of environmental security in the region. And lastly, we have put together an ambitious programme for the annual Mediterranean Conference taking place tomorrow and Tuesday in Budva, Montenegro, this conference will have as its overarching theme the challenges and opportunities for democratic transformation in the Mediterranean region. I'm delighted to inform you that we have assembled a roster of distinguished speakers for the conference, including Secretary General Sanier, Director Lenarčič, Ms. Dunja Mijatović, the representative of Freedom of Media, and of course yourself, President Eftimiu, who we look forward to hearing at the opening session tomorrow afternoon. Throughout our year as Chair of the Mediterranean Partners, we have worked very closely with the Lithuanian Chairmanship. The Chairmanship has brought a strong commitment to the partnership process, and I would like to highlight in particular the personal engagement of the Chairman in Office, Foreign Minister Azubalis, who visited Tunis in April. We share the Chairmanship's ambition for a declaration or decision on the partners at the Vilnius Ministerial Council. Such a document, which could include a fitting tribute to the remarkable determination of the peoples of the Mediterranean region, could also be a tangible demonstration of the OSCE's willingness to extend the hand of friendship and support. We would also like to reform the rather cumbersome decision-making procedures as outlined by Secretary General Sanier with regard to activities and events outside the OSCE area to make the system more flexible and to engage more, enable more timely responses to requests from assistance from our partner countries. We believe any such reform can be done while maintaining the essentials of the consensus method. The transformation process initiated by the events of the Arab Spring will continue for some time to come, and there will be difficulties and roadblocks along the way. But I would like to offer my assurance of the continuity of commitment to the region during the Irish chairmanship of the OSCE in 2012. Looking to the future, it is my firm conviction that the OSCE does have much to offer to its Mediterranean partners. Our relationship must, however, be firmly rooted on the basis of partnership. We must not forget that the momentous changes in the southern Mediterranean region have been conferred not from without, but demanded from within. It is the peoples of the region who have decided to seize the chance for freedom and democracy, and it is the people of the region who must continue to drive this process forward. We can advise, we can assist, we can offer our lessons learned, our best practices, and indeed share some of the mistakes we made along the way. But we cannot impose our priorities, our policies, our vision. The Mediterranean peoples alone must decide where this exciting journey will take them and of how we in the OSCE can assist them. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. And now our final keynote speaker, who is not easy to be present in a couple of the words. In the previous times, he was the only chance for many hunted to speak freely and to be heard openly. But I stick with the formal introduction and say that he's an excellent writer, translated in dozens and dozens of languages, and he's an expert in Mediterranean issues as well. Gospodine Matvejević, imate riječ.
pardon. Bio sam pomalo zbunjen na kojem jeziku da govorim. Ja sam dugo živio u Italiji i predavao na talijanskom i francuskom jeziku. Međutim, normalno je da se govori na jeziku zemlje u kojem se nalazi i kojem se pripada. Prema tome, uvjerio sam se da su prevodioci vrlo dobri i nastojaću da vam sažmem stvari o kojima sam pisao godinama. Moja knjiga Mediteranski brevijar je na svim gotovo vašim jezicima, svim evropskim i mediteranskim jezicima. Prema tome, ono što bude nekompletno u mom izlaganju naći ćete u mojim knjigama, u tom brevijaru i mojim predavanjima s Collège de France. Dakle, Mediteran se nalazi na pragu jednog novog milenija. U onoj povijesti koja se mjeri dugim trajanjem, kako je to nazvao Brodel i neki drugi njegovi sledbenici, možemo govoriti o povijesti Mediterana koja se mjeri u milenijama. Mileniji, hiljadugodište, tisućljeće, je novi se otvara. I slika Mediterana na početku tog novog milenija, o kojem smo napravili već 11 godina, nije nimalo idilična. Sjeverna obala Mediterana zaostaje za kontinentom evropskim, a južna obala zaostaje za sjevernom obalom Mediterana. Cjelina našega mora suočava se s teškoćama i na sjevernoj strani i na južnoj strani. I neki se pitaju, možda je to pitanje umjesno, može li se uopće smatrati cjelinom prostor koji razdiru toliki sporovi, toliki nesporazumi. U ovom času, pogotovo svaka rasprava o Mediteranu, treba voditi računa onom što se dogodilo na južnoj obali Mediterana. Takozvani efekt domina, učinak domino. Režimi koji su nakon kolonijalizma, što je ostavio duboke i tragične tragove, dugo su vladali diktatori i oligarhije. I javlja se jedna mlada generacija koja je stekla novu svestranu izobrazbu o kojoj bi želio nešto reći, informaciju. Kao što se desilo 1848. da su konzervativni oligarhijski režimi u Europi popadali jedan za drugim nakon stanovitih tehnoloških izuma, nakon novih tipova željeznice, pošte, cesta. Tako danas mlade generacije preko internetske kulture dobivaju informacije i više ne ostaju u tami kao što su nekad bili. Oni su ti koji su bili efekt i ferment ovih događaja kojima smo svjedoci. Javlja se jedna usporedba na koju bih želio vama kao diplomatima s više iskustva diplomatskog nego što ga ja imam. Može li se praviti usporedba između onoga što se dogodilo na južnoj obali Mediterana u arapskim zemljama, taj efekt domino, sa sličnim efektom koji se dogodio nakon pada Berlinskog zida? Fenomenološki gledano nema analogija. Na južnoj obali Mediterana nije bilo Gorbačova, nije bilo Pjerestrojke, nije bilo Václava Havela, nije bilo disidenata koji su stvarali tu klimu. Međutim, gdje se može napraviti usporedba? Nakon pada Berlinskog zida jedna rascjeplina historijska se desila u Europi. I ovdje jedan rascjep se dešava koji ćemo svi doživljavati, koji svi doživljavamo. Prema tome, analogija nekih fenomenoloških nema, ali ima u posljedicama sigurno će biti srodnosti. Ne zaboravimo također da dobar dio sjeverne mediteranske obale doživljava također duboke krize, ne samo ekonomske i socijalne, nego i druge. Uzmimo od Grčke do Portugala, od Balkana do Apenina i Iberskog poluotoka. Toliko na ovoj strani, toliko problema. Dodajem jednu kritičku još opasku. Evropska unija nije brinula o Mediteranu. Europa je zanemarivala posebno kolijevku Europe, kako se poetski naziva Mediteran. Objašnjenja koje su nudili razni predstavnici ili teoretičari nisu mogla uvjeriti one kojima su ta obećanja upućena. Ko je vjerovao u to? Nisu vjerovali u njih sigurno ni oni koji su davali takva obećanja. I to je situacija koja dovodi do posljednjih događaja koja nas prati i na ovoj sjevernoj strani Mediterana. Bilo je razni pokušaja da tome ne bude tako. Mediteran se bunio u zaljevima, u lukama, prosvjedovao je na javnim pjacama. Vidjeli smo toliko stvari koje se danas zaboravljaju. Zaboravljaju se razne povelje, karte, čarte, kako se to zove, koje nisu samo ona konferencija u Barceloni, već prije toga čuveni PAM, plan de l'action de la pour la Méditerranée, plan akcije za Mediteran. Zatim jedan plavi plan, plan bleu, koji je donijet u Sofiji Antipolis u Nici. S naznakama razvoja rečeno je tamo do horizonta 2025. godine. Dakle, još nismo prevladali taj horizont. Te tražimo da smo vidjeli toliko raznih deklaracija, susreta, koji su svi ostali bez rezultata, u Napolju, na Malti, u Tunisu, u Splitu, u Palma de Mallorca. To je ostalo puko slovo na papiru, mrtvo slovo na papiru, kako mi to kažemo. I konferencija na u Barceloni u kojoj smo polagali tolike nade, ja govorim pomalo kao krivac, bio sam u prvoj, već sam bio u emigraciji, bio sam u prvoj toj ekipi. Očekivali smo mnogo više 1995. godine, i ostvarilo se mnogo manje. Nakon dogovora u Oslu 1992. izgledalo je da će se stanje na Bliskom istoku popraviti, da je moguć novi odnos Izrael-Palestina, što je rana cijelog Mediterana. Vjerojatno kad bi se to pitanje riješilo, bilo bi drukčija participacija druge obale, južne obale, arapskih zemalja, međutim, do sada smo vidjeli iskustva koja ne obećavaju mnogo. Zavodljive najave koje smo čuli, partnerstva, čula se često riječ partnership na engleskom, na lošem engleskom kojim mi govorimo, diljem Mediterana, kooperacija, voazinaž, susjedstvo, échange, razmjena, solidarnost i tako dalje, sve to skupa nije dalo očekivanog ploda. Vidjeli smo u reakcijama južne obale. Prilikom obilježavanja 10-godišnjice Barcelonskog procesa, ni jedan čelnik arapskog svijeta, ni jedan vođa arapskog svijeta, ni jedan predstavnik arapskog svijeta nije došao na sastanak. Smatrali su se izigranima. A mi smo smatrali, na ovoj našoj obali smo mnogo učinili što smo poticali često uzalud Barcelonsku konferenciju. Valja iz toga izvući zaključke. Dragi prijatelji, draga gospodo, dragi diplomati koji sigurno s više kompetencije pristupate ovom pitanju nego li mi, pisci i profesori. Neke zemlje ne prihvaćaju mediteranstvo, čini im se da se za njega kriju ambicije neokolonijalizma. I tu su razne predrasude, ne samo one koje je Mediteran stekao, nego i one koje se nalaze okolo Mediterana. Što se tiče globalizacije, Mediteran se teško priklanjao globalizaciji. Sama globalizacija je bila teško definirana. Imali smo dva termina, jedan evropski anglofon i globalizacija, iz druge mondializacija, uobičajeni u francuskom i na području francuskog jezika. I tu rezultati nisu dali ono što se očekivalo. Vidjeli smo francuskog predsjednika predložiti jednu uniju za Mediteran, potpuno nepripremljen, potpuno, tako kažem, nespreman da se nešto bitno učiti. I došla je reakcija sa njemačke strane, gospođa Merkel je s razlogom odgovorila, pa imamo već Evropsku uniju, kakva sad Mediteranska unija? Kao što vidite na tim nivoima razne, ove razne polemike i sporovi koji vodimo mi, koji pišemo o Mediteranu, javljaju se u posebnoj formi. Mnogo bi se o tom moglo govoriti, ja želim da ne izađem previše iz okvira koji mi je ponuđen. Vidjeli smo također o tome spor jedan, da li je moguća jedna stvarna konfrontacija i jedna stvarna suradnja, načelo suradnje s jedne strane i s druge strane ono što nije suradnja, nego što je samo trgovina. Koliko se može ući, izaći iz domena samo trgovine koje nije dovoljan. U trgovinu danas su se uključuju, ne samo u trgovinu, uključuju se Kina, Indija, računi koje smo do sad imali, uopće naše predužbe Mediterana i način rješavanja problema Mediterana koje su opterećene historicizmom. Mi svi vidimo Mediteran sa nekom historijskom distancom, sa raznim historijskim referencama koje nisu više dovoljno Vidimo da se je ta nasljednica ili baštinica historije koje je Mediteran prepuštala se historicizmu, da se ta postojbina tragedije, koja je također Mediteran odlijevala odoljevala je teško tragičnim iskušenjima s kojima se suočila. Ta kolijevka mudrosti nije imala mudrosti da na neki način povjeri svoju sudbinu vlastitim mudracima. I tu bih rekao jednu stvar koja mi se čini jako važnom, o kojoj su pisali najveći specijalisti za Mediteran, kojem bi valjalo razmisliti na jedan drugčiji diplomatski način. Jedan od sukoba koji žive mnogi dijelovi svijeta, koji je posebno oštar na Mediteranu. Između dva tipa identiteta. S jedne strane identitet bića, identitet bitisanja. Francuzi to zovu identitet l'être, identity of doing, of being. S druge strane identitet činjenja, identitet du faire, identitet del fare, identity of doing. Na Mediteranu je mnogo jači, vrlo je jak identitet bića, identitet l'être. Uzmite jedan grad kao Napolju. Grad strasti, grad pjesme, grad doista jednog intenzivnog bića, bistvovanja. S druge strane, smeće je na cestama, niko neće da ulaže, nedostaje identity of doing, identitet činjenja, identitet l'être, identitet de l'essere, nazovite ga kako hoćete. Pokušavam u raspravu unijeti malo više jasnosti. Biti i činiti ne daju se uskladiti jednako jedno s drugim na svakom mjestu. I tu je jedna, ne samo jedna filozofska povijesna problematika, nego jedna problematika koju vidimo stvarno kako je. Mogao bi to pokazati, recimo, na Dalmatinskoj obali, kako je nerazumijevanje često kontinenta bilo za Dalmaciju, za Primorje, kako je sada, kako je nemoguće pronaći jednu, zamislite jednu zemlju kao Italiju, koju sam ja proživio 14 godina i koju vjerujem da poznajem, zanemaruje svoje, nema jednu mediteransku politiku. Pokušali smo za vrijeme mandata Prodija, pokušali smo jednu raspravu u Europskoj komisiji. Ja sam jedan od članova jedne grupe koja se zvala Grupa mudrih, ne znam da li spadam u mudre. Pokušali smo, bilo mi jedino drago što smo uspjeli pod Prodijom dovesti naše arapske prijatelje. Ja sam pokušao da im kažem da proizlazim iz jedne zemlje koja se tad zvala Jugoslavija, koja je bila na čelu nesvrstanih zemalja, non alignment, je nesvrstanih zemalja i surađivala tijesno s arapskim zemljama i nam vjeruju da je moguća jedna drugčija novija suradnja u kojoj neće biti izigrani. I to su tako pokušaji, mogao bih vam dugo govoriti o tome koji se nalaze. Još samo par riječi, ako dopustite. Pomišljali smo na tome kako, šta odbaciti, slušajte. Mediteranski amfiteatar, kako ga nazovimo, Mediteran koji je jedan veliki amfiteatar, predugo je izvodio isti repertoar. Tako da su geste na pozornici postale poznate, zatim banalne. Zatim s nepovjerenjem se priznalo. Ti obrasci retorike, dijalektike, politike nastali na našem moru, dugo su služili i potrošili se. Da su se potrošili, nitko nije vidio. Da euklidska geometrija odavno više nije dovoljna. I uoče svake plovidbe nužno je provjeriti ne samo spremnost posade, nego i valjanost opreme, a valjanosti opreme često nije bilo. Tako smo se sukobili u Europskoj komisiji oko dva shvaćanja kulture koja bi valjala. Jedni su govorili, ja citiram to, zasnovati alternativnu intermediteransku kulturu, ponovit ću jer je skomplicirano, ja sam bio protiv te teze, zasnovati alternativnu intermediteransku kulturu. Meni se to čini pogotovo alternativno, vidjeli smo koliko stvari su propale. Prodagao sam jednu drugčiju verziju. Poštovati razlike prevladavajućih. Poštovati razlike prevladavajućih. Ni to sigurno nije samo po sebi dovoljno. Kao da se javlja ponovno jedna ideja Leonarda da Vincija, koji je gledao taj dio Europe i izjavio: od istoka ka zapado u svakoj točki je dioba. Od istoka, da orijenta occidente in ogni punto e divisione. Kako prevladati te diobe od istoka prema zapadu u svakom? Eto, tu su stvari, ja ću vjerojatno, ako neko želi još odgovoriti, kako vidimo ovaj naš dio, Jadran ne bi smio biti jedan zaljev, trebao biti otvoreno more, kako kažu naši pomorci, dugo je bio zaljev. Sad smo mi u Hrvatskoj, to je naša krivica, rasprodali brodogradilišta. Bili smo na trećem i četvrtom mjestu u svjetskoj brodogradnji. Sad nas nema na prvih 60 mjesta. I mi koji to govorimo nismo disidenti, premda nas vlast često tako promatra kao disidente. Mi smo ljudi kritike koji želimo jedan drugčiji odnos i jedan drugčiji Mediteran. Hvala vam.
Hvala gospodine Matvejeviću. Hvala vam na vašoj erudiciji, ali i na uznemirenosti zbog pitanja koja su i danas otvorena na Mediteranu. I'll now invite the partners for cooperation to make some remarks. Those remarks will be followed, of course, by an open debate. We will now start with Algeria, and I'm called Mr. Bouhara. You have the floor, sir.
Monsieur le Président, Mesdames et Messieurs, j'ai encore une fois l'insigne honneur de prendre la parole devant cet important forum. Et j'aimerais à cet égard, au nom de la délégation algérienne, vous saluer et saluer les efforts de l'OSCE en faveur de la paix, de la coopération, du développement, de la démocratie, de la liberté. Je tiens, avec insistance par ailleurs, à exprimer notre profonde reconnaissance au Parlement, au gouvernement de la Croatie et aux dirigeants de cette merveilleuse ville de Dubrovnik. Nous venons d'écouter des interventions d'une qualité particulière et j'avoue sincèrement que j'ai été impressionné par la hauteur de vue de tous ceux qui viennent d'intervenir. Vous comprendrez sans aucun doute que j'entame mon intervention en vous informant de manière succincte sur les réformes, sur les changements actuellement en débat en Algérie. Après une période de concertation avec les partis politiques, les organisations sociales et des personnalités influentes dans le pays, le gouvernement a adopté en Conseil des ministres 12 projets de loi ou d'amendements de loi, et ces projets de loi sont actuellement au niveau des deux chambres du Parlement. On peut donc affirmer que le décor des réformes en Algérie ou du changement en Algérie, le décor est planté. Quels sont les domaines concernés par ces changements? D'abord, nous venons de procéder au niveau du gouvernement à des amendements particulièrement importants du système électoral, avec bien entendu un renforcement de tous les mécanismes de contrôle et de suivi de ces élections. Et à cet égard, notre pays ne voit absolument aucun inconvénient à tout contrôle ou à toute surveillance ou à tout suivi de la part d'organisations internationales. Donc, les domaines concernés, c'est le système électoral, et je pense que c'est le nœud gordien qui peut nous mener à développer notre processus de démocratisation. Il y a des amendements sur la loi des partis politiques, et à ce sujet, il y a une question importante qui se rapporte à cette question, c'est le financement des partis politiques et la définition des programmes de ces partis. Le troisième domaine, et je pense que là nous venons de faire un pas en avant extrêmement important, c'est la place de la femme au sein des assemblées élues. Le gouvernement, après avoir tout à fait au début dans son premier projet arrêté le principe de la parité, 50%, 50%, a en définitive adopté le principe du tiers. Donc désormais, sur la proposition du gouvernement, le tiers, donc 33% des assemblées élues, sont composées de femme. La place donc de la femme sera désormais importante. Nous espérons que le Parlement adoptera les propositions du gouvernement. Le troisième point, c'est les incompatibilités, parce que nous tenons absolument à ce que les acteurs de la vie politique se consacrent essentiellement et parfois même exclusivement à leur mission au niveau des fonctions politiques, des fonctions électives. Le troisième domaine, c'est les collectivités territoriales au niveau de la commune et du département. Et puis ensuite, il y a des amendements importants en ce qui concerne l'information. Et désormais, en Algérie, la voie est ouverte à des chaînes d'information privées. L'autre élément qui concerne ces projets d'amendement de loi, c'est la loi relative aux associations. Voici les principaux donc, domaines qui font actuellement l'objet de débats au niveau du Parlement et qui, en même temps, font l'objet d'un débat populaire et d'un débat au niveau des médias. La presse nationale participe activement, actuellement, à la discussion sur l'ensemble de ces projets. Très rapidement, je vous le dis, en Algérie, notre expérience de démocratisation est passée par trois phases. La première étape consistait, nous pensions que c'était la bonne formule, consistait à adopter un système institutionnel fondé sur le parti unique, et ceci à partir de l'expérience vécue dans le combat pour la libération. Nous pensions que la reconstruction du pays devait absolument se faire sur la base de l'unité de l'ensemble des forces agissantes dans le pays. Cette expérience a pris fin après une fronde populaire en 1988. Les populations sont descendues dans la rue et le pouvoir en place a essayé de répondre aux vœux des manifestants. Et malheureusement, le processus démocratique engagé en 1988 a été sabordé par des mouvements extrémistes. Donc aujourd'hui, nous entamons en fait notre troisième étape de démocratisation du système de gouvernance dans le pays. Et nous tenons absolument à associer la population à ces changements. Ces changements ne peuvent pas se faire sans la participation de la population, ils ne peuvent pas se faire si les réformes, les changements ne concernent pas l'ensemble des activités de la vie nationale. Et d'ailleurs, à ce sujet, des mesures sur le plan social ont été prises et tout récemment, le SMIG, le salaire minimum garanti en Algérie, vient d'être augmenté et ceci à la demande des syndicalistes et d'autres mouvements sociaux dans notre pays. Comme vous le voyez, ce que nous faisons dans notre pays est dicté par des revendications populaires profondes. Et ceci ne nous empêche pas, évidemment, et nous pensons que c'est très important, de suivre avec beaucoup d'intérêt ce qui se passe dans le reste du monde arabe. Ce qui se passe actuellement dans le reste du monde arabe doit faire l'objet d'un suivi particulier par l'ensemble des pays autour de la Méditerranée, par l'ensemble des pays qui ont des relations avec cette partie du monde. Et je sens et je vois que l'OSCE a d'excellentes dispositions pour accompagner de manière positive les changements actuellement en cours dans le monde arabe. Nous sommes bien entendu préoccupés et inquiets par des dérives qui s'opèrent dans la région et en particulier dans un pays voisin, en l'occurrence la Libye, et nous craignons que le non-contrôle de l'armement en raison des déroulements qui se déroulent dans ce pays ne vienne compliquer encore la situation dans la Libye et fatalement au niveau des pays voisins. Les mouvements extrémistes existent, ils sont actifs et nous pensons que le contrôle du mouvement de cet armement est important. Nous saluons et nous considérons que nous sommes intéressés en Algérie, intéressés et concernés par ce qui se passe dans de nombreux pays arabes, et je cite en particulier l'Égypte, la Tunisie et bien entendu le Maroc, et ce qui se passe également avec les mesures positives qui s'opèrent dans un autre pays voisin, et en l'occurrence, le Maroc. Nous œuvrons dans le cadre de l'application des résolutions du Conseil de sécurité, dans le cadre des décisions des Nations Unies, et nous considérons que nous avons l'obligation de participer à la mise en œuvre de ces décisions, mais en précisant dans l'esprit de ces décisions. Car nous ne vous cachons pas que il faut prêter parfois attention aux réactions populaires et nous craignons que l'humiliation qui a été longtemps ressentie par des couches populaires dans ce monde arabe ne génère ou ne contribue à renforcer l'utilisation de la violence. L'humiliation est génératrice de violence. Nous insistons sur cette question. Et en tous les cas, je crois que le passé, c'est le passé, bien entendu, mais nous ressentons ce que nous vivons actuellement dans de nombreux pays comme une nouvelle étape de la période post-coloniale. Nous ne pouvons pas effacer l'histoire et les traces laissées par l'histoire, les séquelles laissées par l'histoire. Et nous estimons que dans de nombreux pays anciennement décolonisés, nous pensons que la décolonisation n'a pas atteint ses objectifs. Et là, j'insiste, la décolonisation n'est pas une œuvre exclusive de ceux qui étaient colonisés, elle est également une obligation pour les anciennes puissances colonisatrices. Donc, c'est ensemble, l'ensemble des peuples de la région, que nous pouvons atteindre les objectifs de la décolonisation, car la décolonisation est peut-être une des entreprises les plus remarquables, les entreprises humaines les plus remarquables de l'histoire contemporaine. Voilà ce que je vous disais, ce que je voulais dire rapidement au cours de cette intervention. Et encore une fois, nous vous disons que en Algérie, nous sommes prêts à apporter toute notre contribution en tant que pays partenaire aux efforts de l'OSCE pour la démocratie, pour le rapprochement des peuples, pour la liberté, pour créer les conditions favorables à une juste coopération entre les pays. Nous sommes disposés à apporter toute notre contribution pour assurer la dignité des peuples et nous sommes également disposés à lutter pour mettre fin à toute forme d'humiliation et d'exploitation. Je vous remercie de votre attention.
Merci beaucoup. I will now ask a representative from Morocco to take the floor, please.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Président, Mesdames, Messieurs, les membres de l'Assemblée parlementaire de l'Organisation pour la sécurité et la coopération en Europe, permettez-moi tout d'abord de présenter en mon nom personnel et au nom des membres de la délégation parlementaire des Royaumes du Maroc, nos vifs remerciements à M. le Président de l'Assemblée pour son grand intérêt et sa sincère sensibilité à notre égard et à l'égard de tous nos frères représentants les parlements de la rive sud de la Méditerranée. Monsieur le Président, nos condoléances n'ont pas été satisfaites complètement, mais nous reconnaissons que vous nous avez donné tout ce que nous avons pu, tout ce que vous avez pu. La démocratie, qui est notre idéal, les doléances, j'ai dit les doléances n'ont pas été satisfaites complètement, mais nous reconnaissons que vous nous avez donné tout ce que vous avez pu. La démocratie, qui est notre idéal, nous impose de continuer à lutter, à solliciter jusqu'à l'obtention de nos droits qui ne sont autres que de nous considérer égal à égal. Honorable Président, permettez-moi aussi de souligner que notre attachement à cette organisation se fortifie, session après session, et ce, en raison des rôles importants que joue cette organisation parlementaire dans le domaine des moyens de coopération et de partenariat dans le cadre de la sécurité et de la stabilité en Europe et sa relation avec ses partenaires méditerranéens et à leur tête, le Royaume du Maroc. Nous saisissons cette occasion pour vous renouveler notre ferme engagement en vue de réaliser les nobles objectifs de notre organisation qui vise à consolider les cadres de sécurité dans notre espace euro-méditerranéen et sur la planète entière. Et de vous rappeler que le Maroc jouit déjà, dans le cadre de la coopération stratégique, d'un statut de partenaire avec l'Union européenne, d'un statut de partenaire pour la démocratie avec l'Assemblée parlementaire du Conseil de l'Europe, d'un statut avancé avec l'Union européenne, sans oublier d'autres engagements dans différents domaines avec nos voisins européens. C'est à ce titre que le Parlement du Royaume du Maroc a l'honneur d'exprimer ses attentes suite à notre proposition lors de la session de Belgrade en Serbie, qui s'est tenu du 6 au 10 juillet 2011 et qui consiste à notre demande de voir notre pays passer du statut de partenaire observateur à celui d'un partenaire à part entière. Pour ce faire, nous réitérons notre appel pour la création d'une cellule de réflexion sur les procédures juridiques, sur les procédures juridiques et organisationnelles en vue d'établir les droits et les obligations des membres et des partenaires de notre organisation parlementaire, aussi que les responsabilités à venir qui incombent à ces derniers, et ce pour faire face aux différents défis que connaît l'espace euro-méditerranéen. Honorable Président, en ce qui concerne les engagements du Royaume du Maroc relatifs à nos partenaires du dit espace, permettez-moi d'insister sur notre nette détermination d'adhérer pleinement et en toute responsabilité à la réalisation des nobles objectifs tracés par notre organisation et qui consiste à consolider les bases de la sécurité et de la coopération au niveau de l'espace euro-méditerranéen. À ce propos, nous sommes heureux de vous exposer les grandes lignes du choix courageux du Maroc, eu égard aux grandes transformations que connaît l'Afrique du Nord et le Moyen-Orient en termes de dynamique politique et sociale et de nommer printemps démocratique. C'est ainsi que le discours de Sa Majesté le Roi Mohamed VI du 9 mars 2011 a été axé sur la volonté du Royaume d'enraciner les libertés et la démocratie, de consolider les acquis de l'état de droit et des institutions et d'élargir les espaces de liberté. Ceci a été couronné par la suite par le référendum du 1er juillet 2011. C'est la nouvelle constitution qui place désormais notre pays au sein du club des anciennes démocraties. Par ailleurs, les acquis démocratiques de notre pays seront davantage renforcés par la grande mobilisation de la société civile, des partis politiques, des syndicats, des intellectuels, des élus et de tous les citoyens marocains en vue de réussir les prochaines échéances électorales. À ce sujet, nous attendons de l'Assemblée de l'Organisation pour la sécurité et la coopération en Europe d'accompagner nos élections en tant qu'observateur de leur déroulement et d'en faire une évaluation. C'est ainsi que nous venons d'élaborer une loi permettant même aux organisations non organisationnelles d'y assister à leur demande. En effet, l'expérience démocratique marocaine mérite bien son renforcement et sa consolidation de la part de nos partenaires européens en vue de créer du Maroc un modèle source d'inspiration pour les pays de la région. Merci pour votre attention.
Thank you, and I'll now invite Ambassador of Israel in Vienna to make some remarks. Ambassador, you have the floor.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. At the outset, I'd like to apologize for the fact that no Israeli parliamentarian has arrived due to the Yom Kippur holiday. And I would like to join my colleagues from the Mediterranean area in thanking the President of the Parliamentary Assembly and the Croatian government and the Parliament for organizing this meeting. We in Israel, of course, are watching very closely the developments around us. There is nobody that could be happier than Israel if the area around us would become more democratic, We all know this cliché that Israel is the only real democracy in the region. We would like not to remain alone in this area. And if the Arab countries would be more democratic with more freedoms, I guess we will all gain from that. It would be easier to all of us to overcome the problems that we still have to overcome, not only between us and the Palestinians, but in the rest of the Middle East. I think that in the framework of the Mediterranean Partners for Cooperation, Israel could definitely be helpful to our neighbors in this process, but 33 years in diplomatic service are enough to know that it's not easy. And I'm not naive about that, but I think that the framework of the partnership of the OSCE and definitely the Parliamentarian Assembly, where Israelis have always taken active part, could assist, maybe even use this opportunity as a bridge for the future, for cooperation between parliamentarians. And I'm making here a distinct difference between me being a representative of my government and parliamentarians that are part of this group that I'm speaking in here right now. And I think that this could be, I think, a positive sign and development for the region, for the Parliamentarian Assembly, for the OSCE in general. And this is just one thing I wanted to mention here as a member of my government talking to parliamentarians who really can make the change in our region. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, for your contribution. And now I'm inviting your colleague, Ambassador of Tunisia in Vienna, to also make some remarks. Ambassador, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Chairman. Monsieur le Président, il m'est particulièrement agréable de m'adresser au nom de mon pays à cet auguste forum de l'Assemblée parlementaire de l'OSCE à un moment où la Tunisie vit une transition démocratique historique. La tenue de ce forum coïncide avec la nouvelle donne dans la région. Le peuple tunisien, dans un élan de responsabilité et de maturité, a surpris le monde entier en s'élevant contre l'oppression et l'injustice pour mener une révolution inédite, conduite en avant-garde par les jeunes générations, lui permettant d'accéder à la dignité, à la liberté, à la démocratie et au respect des droits fondamentaux. La Tunisie nouvelle a d'ores et déjà entamé les premiers jalons inscrits par la révolution, notamment à travers l'établissement d'une instance supérieure pour la réalisation des objectifs de la révolution, la réforme politique et la transition démocratique, et l'instance supérieure indépendante pour les élections qui est chargée, avec l'appui d'organisations et d'observateurs internationaux, de l'organisation et de la supervision du processus électoral de l'Assemblée constituante du 23 octobre prochain, et auquel prendront part 11 000 candidats représentant 70 partis politiques sur les 115 partis politiques autorisés, en plus des listes indépendantes pour pouvoir à 218 sièges. De même, la Tunisie, qui est partie à différents traités et conventions, a récemment adhéré au protocole facultatif au Pacte international des droits civils et politiques, au protocole facultatif à la Convention contre la torture, au traité de Rome relatif à la Cour pénale internationale, et à la Convention internationale relative à la protection contre les disparitions forcées. Ces dispositions viennent conforter l'amnistie générale concernant les prisonniers politiques afin d'associer toutes les parties à la vie politique et aux choix de société identifiés en toute liberté. La Tunisie s'engage ainsi à mettre fin à la distorsion entre les textes juridiques et la pratique. Le gouvernement en étroite concertation avec toutes les parties, notamment avec les représentants de la société civile, met tout en œuvre pour renforcer l'indépendance de l'appareil judiciaire, dynamiser le tissu associatif, enrichir l'esprit de dialogue et de compréhension mutuelle pour garantir le fonctionnement harmonieux des mécanismes de contrôle et d'observation et de consacrer la séparation entre l'État et les partis politiques. Les chiffres de la conjoncture économique, Monsieur le Président, en Tunisie, démontrent l'urgence de la situation et le besoin pressant d'agir pour retrouver rapidement la croissance requise pour relancer l'économie et créer des emplois. La situation est évidemment difficile. Elle est néanmoins gérable si l'économie est relancée avec détermination et avec l'appui requis. Autant d'indicateurs faisant de la relance de l'économie l'un des objectifs majeurs, et même au même titre que le suivi vigilant de la transition démocratique, de la refonte des institutions et de la garantie de toutes les conditions pour favoriser et consolider les prémices de reprise économique qui se font jour au vu du retour de la sécurité, de l'équilibre à assurer entre la gestion des attentes et les requêtes sociales, d'une part, et la stabilité macroéconomique et budgétaire, d'autre part. Cette brève présentation, Monsieur le Président, de la situation dans mon pays m'amène à vous faire part de certaines réflexions, s'inscrivant justement dans le cadre de nos débats sur le thème de notre présent forum quant aux voies et moyens de faire de la Méditerranée un espace de liberté, de sécurité et de justice, et j'ajouterai de coopération. À ce propos, nous sommes convaincus que les révolutions populaires du monde arabe ont créé une opportunité sans commune mesure pour l'Europe de contribuer à une transformation radicale de la région euro-méditerranéenne en un espace démocratique, de paix, de protection des droits humains fondamentaux et de prospérité. Aussi est-il urgent d'identifier ensemble une nouvelle vision des relations entre les pays riverains et un traitement différencié en faveur de ces pays à travers la mise en place d'outils de convergence économique et sociale, aboutissant graduellement à la libre circulation des marchandises, des services, des capitaux et des personnes, en vue de créer un espace plus ambitieux et plus solidaire, et d'édifier un espace économique commun susceptible de promouvoir les synergies entre les économies de la région et consolider la paix sociale, la croissance et le développement durable des pays de la rive sud. En fait, la co-appropriation des partenariats au niveau de la Méditerranée par l'ensemble des pays de la région requiert une réponse urgente et adéquate pour relever les défis majeurs auxquels les pays riverains continuent à faire face dont la pression démographique, la pauvreté, l'insécurité alimentaire, l'impact de la crise économique et financière, ainsi que les phénomènes de l'extrémisme, du terrorisme et de la migration clandestine. À cet égard, nous nous félicitons de la création du Task Force Union européenne-Tunisie, qui permet une meilleure perception des défis et des besoins de la Tunisie et intervient pour mieux coordonner le soutien européen et international afin que l'aide soit plus rapide et plus efficace. Les deux conventions signées récemment à Tunis ne manqueront pas de contribuer à la multiplication des opportunités d'emploi, à la lutte contre le chômage et à l'ouverture de nouvelles perspectives de coopération entre la Tunisie et l'Union européenne. Monsieur le Président, je voudrais formuler les remerciements et la reconnaissance du peuple et du gouvernement tunisien aux pays amis représentés dans ce forum, ainsi qu'aux organisations et instances multilatérales qui ont manifesté leur solidarité et se sont engagés à appuyer les efforts de mon pays lors de sa transition démocratique. De tels engagements revêtent une importance toute particulière, d'autant que la Tunisie a fait face à une situation rendue encore plus délicate suite au flux massif de 900 000 personnes déplacées aux frontières du Sud que mon pays a traitées dès les premiers moments avec ouverture et détermination, où encore une fois, les forces vives de la Tunisie ont démontré leur attachement à la solidarité, à la défense et à la protection des droits humains. La Tunisie est sensible à la reconnaissance internationale, à la générosité de son peuple à cette occasion. Monsieur le Président de la République a récemment invité la communauté internationale à se mobiliser davantage pour garantir le rapatriement des réfugiés encore dans les camps et à inscrire d'une manière formelle et claire les principes de solidarité et de coopération en matière de partage équitable des charges dans les chartes internationales y afférentes afin qu'ils constituent la base d'une action humanitaire à caractère obligatoire. D'autre part, nous voudrions souligner l'importance de toutes les parties concernées d'œuvrer de façon concertée en vue de la mise au point de stratégies cohérentes visant à asseoir les alternatives à la migration irrégulière fondées sur la solidarité et le développement. Monsieur le Président, pour conclure, je me dois de réitérer nos remerciements à l'Assemblée parlementaire de l'OSCE pour l'élan de solidarité effective qu'elle a manifesté avec la Tunisie. Le déploiement de ses équipes d'observation sur le territoire tunisien, conduit par M. Miliori, le vice-président, s'inscrit dans le cadre du renforcement du courant de dialogue et de concertation entre les deux parties, à un moment particulièrement important de l'histoire de la Tunisie, et où l'Assemblée parlementaire s'est engagée à soutenir la transition démocratique, notamment à travers l'appui au processus électoral au service des valeurs de la paix, de la sécurité et du développement. Nous sommes confiants, Monsieur le Président, nous sommes confiants que nos partenaires euro-méditerranéens, notamment, ne manqueront pas de consolider le processus de partenariat dans l'intérêt mutuel, car nous sommes convaincus que la réussite de l'expérience tunisienne, à laquelle nous croyons et œuvrons sans relâche, aura un impact certain au-delà de ses frontières. Cette réussite sera bien évidemment aussi celle de nos partenaires, devant cette avancée historique et auquel il revient d'assurer l'accompagnement immédiat, effectif et adéquat. Mr. Chairman, I would like, before concluding, to express our sincere gratitude to the Croatian authorities and to yourself, Mr. Chairman, for your support to my country as well for the excellent organization of this important forum. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ambassador, on your contribution. Of course, we all wish you all the best on Election Day and, of course, beyond. And now I will declare a debate is open. But, dear colleagues, please help me in order to help us all. Due to the fact that we have more than 20 speakers, I strongly advise all to speak up to 3 minutes. So please keep your interventions as brief as possible. We will now start with the debate with Mr. Tony Lloyd. Tony, you got the floor.
Thank you, Tonino. Can I begin by saying this? The wave of hope that spread throughout the Middle East as a result of the Arab Spring is genuine. I met young people in Egypt recently in Cairo who look with tremendous enthusiasm to change in their own countries. But we ought to remember there is a sadder side of that. When Mohamed Bouazizi, you referred to him before, killed himself in Tunis late last year, he killed himself because he could no longer tolerate the level of abuse to which he was subjected by the authorities, and there was no one to speak out for him. And that no one included those of us from countries like my own who didn't raise these issues of human rights abuse, who didn't raise the issues strongly enough of democracy and the need for change throughout the Arab world. And that's why in that context we must take this opportunity to say that whilst the Arab Spring is welcome, there are still areas where we've got to continue the political pressure as well as the practical assistance. And if I can turn first of all to the position in Syria, 3,000 people have died in Syria since the struggle for some form of political freedom began. That's 3,000 deaths that lie in the hand of the Assad regime in Damascus. But what is astonishing, and I say this to our colleagues around here, what is astonishing is that the world, which acted quite rightly in Libya, quite rightly to put even young men from my own country and their lives at risk, also in France and other places, the world, where it wanted to act with respect to Syria, has found those actions of the United Nations blocked with the veto, sadly, from Russia and from China. And I must simply say to our Russian colleagues, 3,000 deaths from a regime that is now bankrupt deserve better than the use of a veto, because all of us have got to recognise that narrow self-interest, actually, even though we all have national interests, my own country has national interests, narrow self-interest has got to be balanced by recognition of the rights and the freedoms of other people that we speak for. And in that context, in the few short moments I have left, I'd like to just refer to the position of the Palestinians. I'm delighted that the Israeli ambassador is here. Israel is a great country, but Israel is committing a terrible wrong with respect to the people of Gaza. I was there in Gaza a few months ago. I saw the impact of the economic siege that is a collective punishment against the innocent in Gaza, as well as, obviously, those involved in acts of terrorism. When we realise that 10 years ago, only 10% of the people of Gaza depended on aid for their livelihoods, that figure is now 70%. When we see 50% of people in Gaza are now unemployed, when our Algerian colleague told us quite rightly that humiliation in the end leads to violence, every one of us should listen to that message. If we don't speak up for the people of Syria, if we don't speak up for the Palestinians, if we don't speak up and demand that Israel and the Palestinians sit down, and I say to our colleagues in the United States, the people with most influence on Tel Aviv, please now make that two-state solution a reality by bringing the parties to the table and getting a negotiating process going. If we don't give hope, then hope actually turns to despair, and despair does turn to violence.
Thanks, Tony Lloyd from United Kingdom. And I'm calling Madame Maria Arena from Belgium.
Merci beaucoup. Je tiens tout particulièrement à remercier l'Assemblée de l'OSCE pour les débats qui nous sont donnés, que ce soit hier avec nos amis arméniens et Azerbaïdjan, ou que ce soit aujourd'hui sur la réalité du pourtour méditerranéen. Alors c'est vrai que la politique pour la Méditerranée que nous avons menée jusqu'à maintenant était menée sous une vision un peu naïve, dans le meilleur des cas, et surtout très intéressée et à sens unique. Et on l'a vu, elle n'a fait que renforcer le fossé qui existait entre les populations pauvres et les populations riches. Alors l'Europe, effectivement, a favorisé l'économie de marché sans veiller à une redistribution. Elle a favorisé le libre-échange, souvent dans un sens, ou encore elle a favorisé la libre circulation des capitaux et surtout la détention des personnes. Alors tous ces outils qui ont été mis en place, que ce soit par l'Union pour la Méditerranée, par le processus de Barcelone ou encore par la politique de voisinage, tous ces outils n'ont pas permis d'apporter des solutions aux populations du pourtour méditerranéen. Alors aujourd'hui, que vivons-nous? Est-ce que nous allons vers la démocratie? Nous l'espérons tous, et je remercie tout particulièrement notre collègue tunisien qui nous a fait rapport sur la situation en Tunisie. Et je rends hommage à tout le travail qui a été réalisé par les instances de transition en Tunisie qui ont pu, dans toutes les difficultés qu'elles connaissent, organiser ces élections, et nous leur espérons le meilleur processus démocratique. Alors vivons-nous un moment historique? Oui, nous vivons ce moment historique qui nous montre une fois encore que les aspirations pour la liberté et pour la dignité ne connaissent pas de frontières. Alors quel avenir pour nos relations entre l'Europe, l'Afrique du Nord et le Moyen-Orient? Je dirais tout d'abord, et notre collègue Tony Lloyd l'a dit tout à l'heure, il y a une zone éclatée, une zone de conflit, ne l'oublions pas, il y a effectivement ce conflit israélo-palestinien, nous vivons actuellement le conflit libyen, il y a aujourd'hui en Syrie des dizaines de personnes qui décèdent tous les jours, et donc nous devons favoriser des accords intra-régionaux qui sont des accords de paix. Deuxièmement, nous devons également favoriser le multilatéral. Nous n'avons pas d'exclusivité avec des pays du pourtour méditerranéen. Et je pense que l'Europe a un rôle important à jouer dans ce multilatéral. Troisième point, et c'est peut-être ce que nous avons le mieux réussi en tant qu'Européens, c'est le soutien à la société civile, et particulièrement le soutien à la société civile femme. Et donc je tiens à renforcer notre capacité de soutenir la société civile, bien entendu dans des pays qui ont déjà fait leur révolution, mais aussi dans les pays qui sont aujourd'hui en transition, peut-être vers des révolutions, mais en tout cas vers des réformes. Alors en conclusion, je dirais qu'à l'heure où l'Europe est tournée vers elle-même, elle est tournée vers elle-même parce qu'elle vit la crise financière et économique, il est important que cette Europe ne se referme pas sur elle-même, qu'elle résiste aux sirènes de l'urgence pour faire du long terme et surtout pour regagner la confiance du monde arabe. Merci.
Merci beaucoup, Madame Arena. Now it's time to hear our Vice President Jean-Charles Gardette from Monaco, please.
Merci, Monsieur le Président. Monsieur le Président, le printemps arabe est un moment historique aussi extraordinaire qu'inattendu. qui a surpris les pouvoirs politiques en place, mais aussi l'Europe et la communauté internationale. Alors, on parle du monde arabe, mais dans cette ère à la fois géographique et culturelle, se reflètent des situations différentes, difficilement comparables. Certains pays sont déjà engagés dans un processus de transition démocratique, la Tunisie, l'Égypte et plus récemment la Libye. Dans d'autres pays, les dirigeants ont engagé des réformes, mais l'issue est encore incertaine. Évoquons l'Algérie, le Maroc, la Jordanie aussi. Dans d'autres États encore, des conflits armés sanglants affectent les populations. Je pense en particulier, malheureusement, à la Syrie. Et enfin, dans d'autres pays, les manifestations contre les régimes en place sont réprimées sans retenue, les oppositions sont muselées et les dirigeants cherchent à gagner du temps sans engager de quelconque réforme. Il s'agit du Yémen, de l'Arabie Saoudite, du Bahreïn et de quelques autres. Alors, Monsieur le Président, que retenir de ces mouvements du printemps arabe? Eh bien, ce que je retiens en premier lieu, c'est un changement de regard de la part de nous autres Européens, je dirais du monde occidental. Pour nous, les populations arabes ont cessé de symboliser terrorisme et soumission à un dictateur pour incarner des peuples debout, courageux, fiers et qui exigent maintenant la démocratie. Le moment est historique parce que la région du Proche-Orient risque de se voir fragmenter davantage avec l'émergence d'une nouvelle polarisation autour d'une part de la Turquie, d'autre part de l'Iran et de l'Arabie Saoudite. Une telle fragmentation serait sans aucun doute les prémices d'un éloignement des pays de la région de l'ère européenne, le Proche-Orient devenant ainsi l'Asie de l'Ouest, dans laquelle la Chine et l'Inde prendraient le pas sur l'Europe. La tendance générale de ce printemps arabe, c'est un ras-le-bol de la rue amorcé par la jeunesse, facilité par l'utilisation d'Internet et des réseaux sociaux, sans structure religieuse ou partisane préalable. Le programme n'est pas clairement défini, il s'agit plutôt d'une demande populaire ferme de voir les dictateurs tomber. Ce sont des révolutions civiles plutôt que politiques. Ce mouvement initial a ensuite été récupéré et structuré au niveau politique pour engager le processus de démocratisation. J'ai eu l'occasion de me rendre en Tunisie ainsi qu'en Égypte il y a 15 jours pour rencontrer les autorités et de nombreux groupes politiques. L'OSCE n'a pas vocation à donner des leçons de démocratie à un État quelconque et chaque pays doit trouver son propre modèle démocratique. Néanmoins, la coopération entre l'OSCE et les démocraties émergentes du monde arabe doit se concevoir comme un accompagnement actif si ces pays en expriment la demande, en leur offrant un cadre de dialogue effectif, en suggérant l'utilisation de mécanismes pertinents et enfin en faisant le nécessaire pour proposer l'enracinement des valeurs de la démocratie, de l'état de droit et des droits de l'homme. Les processus engagés demeurent incertains quant à l'issue de la transition démocratique et un doute plane fortement quant au risque de confiscation de ces révolutions par des militaires, par du personnel politique recyclé de la part des anciens partis au pouvoir ou éventuellement aussi par des partis religieux. La démocratie ne se décrète pas. Elle nécessite, comme nous le savons tous, une volonté permanente de l'animer. Il est donc essentiel aussi de soutenir la société civile et tout particulièrement les réseaux d'entrepreneurs, mais aussi absolument les femmes et la jeunesse qui manque d'expérience et doit pouvoir acquérir cette expérience auprès des pays de la rive nord. Alors, plus que jamais, il est nécessaire de montrer et de démontrer de la solidarité à l'égard de ces nouvelles démocraties, notamment en matière de développement économique, car s'il n'y a pas de répartition équitable des richesses, la jeunesse ne sera pas satisfaite et ne trouvera pas ce pourquoi elle a fait sa révolution. Il faut absolument favoriser la lutte contre la corruption, mais aussi les investissements étrangers, l'accès aux marchés européens et des fonds dédiés aux investissements dans ces nouvelles démocraties arabes. Voilà pourquoi, Monsieur le Président, il est de nos intérêts réciproques, à la fois à nous, pays de l'OSCE, et à ces démocraties émergentes, d'éviter des dérives pour voir des tyrans remplacer d'autres tyrans, mais aussi pour assurer une transition pacifique vers la démocratie et le respect des droits de l'homme, et pour enfin aboutir à une stabilisation économique et sociale qui permettra à l'Europe de stabiliser les politiques migratoires et de sécuriser les échanges commerciaux et énergétiques. Je vous remercie.
Merci. 2 minutes more for Vice President. Now it's time to hear another Vice President, Signor Riccardo Migliori. Please address us.
Cari colleghi, caro Torino, siccome questo è l'ultimo degli interventi che ho fatto in questa sessione, voglio a nome di tutta la delegazione italiana innanzitutto ringraziarti per il tuo lavoro e ringraziare tutta la delegazione croata per questa straordinaria riunione che abbiamo avuto a Dubrovnik. Ne abbiamo parlato più volte, ma avete fatto un lavoro straordinario e ci avete messo nelle condizioni di svolgere degli straordinari dibattiti. Insieme a te vorrei anche ringraziare gli altri amici della delegazione, Furio Radin, Frano Matusic, Romana Jerkovic, Mario Zubovic, con i quali ci vediamo ogni anno nelle nostre relazioni bilaterali riguardanti le nostre minoranze. Brevemente vorrei anche ringraziarti per quello che hai detto nella tua introduzione. Io non vorrei parlare di quello che accadrà, sta accadendo e accaduto nei paesi del Nord Africa. Vorrei parlare su quello che accadrà da noi, perché cambia anche la nostra storia, cioè sta cambiando il sistema di relazioni tra le due rive del Mediterraneo. Il canale di Sicilia e Gibilterra sono ancora più stretti, diciamo, da un punto di vista culturale e politico. E come ha detto il professor Matvievich, nei nostri Mediterranei, perché noi viviamo in una sorta di sesto continente all'interno del quale esistono più realtà e più spazi. Allora, che cosa voglio dire? Voglio dire che come dopo la caduta del muro la nostra attenzione si è rivolta inevitabilmente verso est, adesso dobbiamo rivolgere la nostra attenzione verso sud. C'è questa notizia straordinaria. La Mongolia vuole diventare paese partner dell'OSCE e Petros sta per andare a Shanghai. C'è questa notizia straordinaria. Andiamo a fare il monitoraggio elettorale in Tunisia. Cosa voglio dire? L'anno scorso ci siamo lasciati dicendo abbiamo un'organizzazione in crisi, oggi invece abbiamo un'organizzazione, l'OSCE, che aperta può avere grandi capacità espansive e grandi capacità dinamiche. La storia ci dice che come c'è una sicurezza euroasiatica, dobbiamo ormai parlare di una sicurezza euroafricana e lavorare affinché i paesi del Maghreb siano integrati, perché ci chiedono questo, a livello di sicurezza nella nuova OSCE. C'è bisogno forse di una nuova Helsinki. Aldo Moro l'aveva già individuato nel 75, non c'è pace in Europa senza una pace e una sicurezza nel Mediterraneo. È venuto il momento di un salto di qualità per la nostra organizzazione. Dobbiamo pensare a modificare i confini dell'OSCE, perché stanno cambiando i confini della democrazia. E quindi abbiamo bisogno di uno sforzo in questo senso. Non è il momento delle gestioni, è il momento forse di avere una sorta di follia visionaria per cambiare sul serio, per essere cioè all'altezza dei grandi cambiamenti che la storia all'improvviso ha fatto sì che in questi anni si registrassero. Cioè tutto l'inverso di quello che aveva detto Fukuyama sulla fine della storia. La storia sta incominciando proprio adesso e noi dobbiamo essere all'altezza di questa sfida.
Please.
Oh. Thank you, Mr. Chair. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for their bright idea to dedicate time to this very important topic, freedom, justice and security in the Mediterranean region. As was pointed out in the excellent speeches we heard from our panelists, the Mediterranean and the Arab region are going through historical but also very delicate processes. These processes will continue for quite some time, and I fully support the proposal made this morning by Jean-Claude Gardetto, our colleague from Monaco, to take time in our upcoming summer meeting in his beautiful country to continue these discussions on the region. Mr. Matvejevic spoke about the so-called domino effect. We hope for a domino effect where positive democratic developments are concerned. But we also see threats, Mr. Chair. For instance, the large amount of weapons in the region, we should find ways to prevent them from getting in the hands of terrorists. In the morning, Isabel Pozuelo, our colleague from Spain, spoke, amongst others, about the importance for us as OSCE Parliamentary Assembly of having strong and warm, definitely not frozen, relationships with the organizations and bodies of people in the Arab region. I fully support that. At this very moment, dear colleagues, the first meeting of women from Libya is taking place in Cairo. As we all know, women in situations of conflict are 2 times victim. They are deprived of their basic human rights, and they are victims of rape. Rape used as an instrument of war. But women are not only victims. Women are part of the solution. Without women, the so-called Arab Spring might probably never turn into summer, but rather go back to winter. Those Libyan women from all walks of life, from a broad range of ideological and professional backgrounds, including activists, housewives, academics, entrepreneurs and young bloggers gathered in Cairo, sent us a message today, asking attention for their meeting. They make an appeal: talk with us, not about us. Hedy Fry, Special Representative on Gender, and I thought it would be a good idea to make copies of their declaration for all of you. You can find them outside. Please take it, read it, take it home, and spread it. Let's talk with them. Thank you.
Thank you for your contribution. Sada pozivam kolegicu Gordanu Čomić iz Srbije da nam se obrati.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. I want to support the idea of Ms. Hedy Fry and my colleague from Netherlands to send a clear message to women from Libya and the region that we can hear them and we do hear them. And I think that this assembly, the Gender Task Force, assembly as a whole, should pay much more attention in women organizing in the countries of Northern Africa, in the countries that we now put under the headline of Arab Spring. You may say that organizing women in such a moment, paying attention of what women from the region are saying is small things, is irrelevant. There are much more important things, much higher priorities, and dealing with women issue nowadays is small. And I can just share with you a message to think about. Whenever you think that it is a small step, small things to deal with gender issues or women equality or women movement, try to spend a night with a mosquito, a real small one mosquito, and in the morning you try to share with me, does it matter to deal with a very small thing or not? Please hear the women from Northern Africa. It is important for democratization and development in the region. Thank you.
Hvala gospođi Čomić na njezinom doprinosu. I'm inviting Mr. Dao Silva from Portugal.
Monsieur le Président, chers collègues, Pour le Portugal, les questions de la Méditerranée sont des questions très importantes. Le Portugal, c'est l'avant-porte de la Méditerranée occidentale et c'est un couloir entre la Méditerranée et l'Atlantique. Et en outre, il faut encore invoquer l'histoire du Portugal comme une histoire d'un pays de découverte. La mer, pour les Portugais, c'est quelque chose qui ne sépare pas, mais plutôt qui unit les personnes et les continents, comme l'a dit très bien un des plus grands écrivains portugais, un poète, Fernando Pessoa. Il faut encore rappeler justement le rôle de la Méditerranée comme un instrument d'union de l'étang très très ancien. Les Phéniciens, les Romains, les Grecs, les Vénitiens, les Dalmatiens, les Arabes, ils ont appris que la Méditerranée, c'était un instrument, un espace de développement, surtout quand il était un espace de paix. Donc, les temps les plus récents, nous avons assisté à un temps de guerre, de méfiance, de stagnation, parfois, entre le nord et le sud, entre l'est et l'ouest. Parfois, même des frontières infranchissables, des frontières infranchissables dans les plans économiques, politiques, sociaux, culturels, linguistiques, démographiques même. Donc, je pense qu'il faut réapprendre à vivre dans une Méditerranée renouvelée, réinventer les traits d'union entre une Europe qui est aussi une Europe en crise économique et financière, et avec des pays qui vivent en état exceptionnel, un état de printemps démocratique dans le monde arabe et surtout dans le nord d'Afrique, c'est-à-dire dans la rive sud de la Méditerranée. Donc il faut réinventer cet espace de paix parce que la paix apporte le développement, la paix apporte la liberté et surtout la sécurité, ce qu'il faut vraiment développer. Donc, je dois dire et souligner que la OSCE a fait des efforts extraordinaires en ce qui concerne le dialogue dans la Méditerranée. Il faut le souligner, en effet, mais il faut dire qu'il faut continuer ce dialogue. Il faut aboutir à un engagement de nous tous qui fasse de la Méditerranée une mer qui unisse de plus en plus et ne sépare plus. Merci.
Thank you, Mr. Silva. The next speaker is Mr. Adamus Adamou from Cyprus.
Thank you, Mr. President. And has a partnership with and within the Mediterranean region.
Closer to the microphone, dear colleague.
Okay, Mr. President. Enhance a partnership with and within the Mediterranean region constitutes a key tool towards freedom, security and justice all over Europe and this region. The more necessary is partnership in light of the Arab Spring, of which the geopolitical consequences and impact on global security challenges remain uncertain. For the European Union in particular, it is important that progress regarding the external dimension of freedom, security and justice, especially in terms of the Union's migration and asylum strategy, border control and Frontex, ensure greater solidarity among EU member states, and it is also important that such progress be reflected in a win-win process with Mediterranean partners. Yet, creating an area of freedom, security and justice in Eastern Mediterranean remains a wishful thought as long as protracted conflicts which pertain to violation of international law and human rights persist. Even more, given this region's emergence as a new protagonist on the global energy scene. Therefore, dialogue and cooperation must be used in their full potential. a constructive approach on behalf of the countries of the Eastern Mediterranean region should be no other than of their pursuance of good neighborly relations with due respect to international law and fundamental human rights. Also, the settlement of the Cyprus problem, according with the international law and pertinent UN resolutions, will also add and act positively in the situation of Eastern Mediterranean, and we express the hope that the meeting of the leaders of the two communities with the UN Secretary General at New York in 2 weeks will end up with positive results that will ensure the fundamental rights of all Cypriots, Greek and Turkish alike. The OSCE should enhance its political scope and input in the Mediterranean region. The OSCE political role and how best this organization could ensure implementation of its fundamental principles are highly relevant in efforts towards freedom, security, and justice in Europe and the Mediterranean. This should be high priorities in the V2V dialogue and in eventual negotiations on a constituent document for the OSCE. Thank you, Mr. President.
Thank you, Mr. Adamu. Now I'm inviting Mr. Mohamed El Moufid from Morocco to speak to us.
Monsieur le Président, Excellences, Madame et Messieurs, je tiens d'abord à remercier vivement Monsieur le Président de l'organisation à l'intérêt qu'il donne au pays de la rive sud de la Méditerranée dans le Royaume du Maroc. Pays de tolérance et de diversité a été épargné par les soulèvements qui impactent les pays arabes. En effet, le Maroc, pays de la rive sud de la Méditerranée, politiquement stable, se démarque nettement par la hausse des investissements directs étrangers qui ont connu une évolution de 23% entre 2010 et 2011. Ceci grâce à la diversification de l'évolution positive et ses partenariats avec les pays amis et de l'Europe. La stabilité économique et sociale reste un atout majeur caractérisant l'ouverture du Maroc sur le reste du monde. Le contexte politique régional et la volonté de l'État marocain ont aidé notre pays à faire figure d'exception en matière de réformes constitutionnelles, mais ainsi politiques. En effet, le Maroc œuvre incessamment avec les différents partenaires dans le domaine de la promotion de l'État des droits de l'homme. Dans ce contexte, je voudrais bien rappeler les progrès accomplis par le Royaume sous l'impulsion de Sa Majesté le Roi Mohamed VI en matière de la démocratie politique, de modernisation et de développement économique et social. Et ce dans ce contexte régional marqué par le printemps arabe pour la démocratie et la liberté. À cet égard, je peux citer quelques exemples de réformes initiées par le Maroc qui sont comme suite. Adoption d'une nouvelle constitution, projet de régionalisation avancé dans le projet d'autonomie du Sahara marocain. L'indépendance de la justice. Le code de la famille qui conforme les droits de la femme et des enfants. L'institutionnalisation de l'égalité entre les sexes. L'adoption d'un nouveau code électoral qui répond aux exigences de la société civile et qui renforce la place de la femme et des jeunes dans la vie politique. Le nombre des femmes élues dans les communes est passé de 125 femmes en 2003 à 3406 en 2009. La création de l'instance centrale de la lutte contre la corruption, la création du Conseil de la concurrence, la création d'autres institutions de la bonne gouvernance. La dynamique engendrée par ces réformes a permis au Maroc de se positionner sur l'échiquier régional des internationales a été couronné par le statut avancé avec l'Union européenne. Le Maroc, qui soutient toutes les initiations les initiatives visant la promotion de la tolérance, de dialogue interreligieux et la lutte contre toutes les formes de discrimination réitèrent l'importance de renforcer la coopération entre l'OSCE et l'Alliance des civilisations. Monsieur le Président, nos partenaires méditerranéens se sont préoccupés constamment de questions relatives à la lutte contre le terrorisme, à la sécurité des frontières, à la gestion de l'eau, aux défis pour la sécurité environnementale, à la gestion de la migration subsaharienne et à la tolérance et la non-discrimination, souhaitant ensemble de renforcement de partenariat et l'appui continu de l'OSCE afin de créer un bassin méditerranéen stable, prospéré et intégré. Beaucoup de personnalités de renommée internationale visitent le Maroc, attestant que notre pays vit doucement, mais sûrement sa transition démocratique. Elle cite la dernière réforme constitutionnelle comme événement spectaculaire. Ainsi, il apprécie ouvertement les chantiers structurants ouverts par le Maroc dans le domaine économique. C'est pour cela que nous appelons nos amis européens et autres à soutenir le Maroc dans son exercice de réforme et de transition démocratique. Nous les invitons aussi à soutenir le peuple marocain dans ses efforts de progrès, de prospérité et de maintien de la paix sans la région de l'Afrique du Nord. Surtout, l'État marocain vient d'édifier une nouvelle politique œuvrant pour la primauté à la loi, à la liberté et aux droits de l'homme. Dans ce même ordre d'idées, nous tenons à signaler que notre pays entretient de bonnes relations, de partenariat avec tous les pays amis avec lesquels il partage des expériences en matière de sécurité, de lutte contre le crime organisé, contre le terrorisme et en matière de renforcement, de maintien de la paix et des échanges entre différents pays. Aussi, nous construisons notre partenariat sur la base de principes universels et sur les spécificités sociales de la société marocaine dont nos objectifs sont la préservation d'une paix sociale, un équilibre de distribution des richesses économiques et l'interdiction du parti unique. Et merci, Monsieur le Président.
Thank you, Mr. El Moufid. Now I will give the floor to Madame Isabel Pozuelo, our Vice President from Spain.
Gracias, Presidente. Voy a ser, intento ser breve, porque en el debate que está siendo largo y muy intenso, muy interesante, se han dicho ya cuestiones muy importantes. Pero me gustaría resaltar algunas ideas que pueden ayudar también a este debate y a las decisiones futuras que tengamos que tomar en nuestra organización, en la Asamblea Parlamentaria de la OCE. Realmente, como ya algunos han dicho aquí, algunos de nuestros colegas, el centro neurálgico, el centro geopolítico del mundo ha variado. Ya no es la antigua Europa, ya no es el mundo euroatlántico, Estados Unidos y Canadá, ya no es Rusia, los grandes polos donde se discutían y se tomaban las grandes decisiones que dirigían la escena mundial. Ese centro neurálgico se traslada y hay unos nuevos movimientos, por una parte en Asia, Euroasia y ahora de nuevo en el Mediterráneo, que nos ha sorprendido a todos. El viejo Mediterráneo que vuelve a tomar el protagonismo histórico que muchos siglos atrás había tenido. Y nos sorprende, aunque sea un grito de libertad, un grito de paz, un grito de convivencia y un grito de igualdad, lo que se oye en las sociedades de todo el norte de África y en el mundo árabe. lo que hemos venido en llamar la primavera árabe, porque es un renacimiento de estos principios, nos está obligando a prestar una atención preeminente a esta región. Y el papel nuestro, ya lo estamos viendo, es importante. El papel de la Asamblea Parlamentaria, de la OCE, está viendo cómo tiene la flexibilidad suficiente, lo decía nuestro colega Migliori, para atender rápidamente esas nuevas necesidades. Pero yo me gustaría señalar dos aspectos. Por una parte, ha habido algunas colegas que han manifestado la importancia del apoyo a las mujeres en estos movimientos. Desde el inicio de las revoluciones árabes se vio cómo las mujeres tenían un especial protagonismo, aunque habían estado durante décadas aisladas y silenciadas. Pero yo creo que ese nuevo protagonismo de las mujeres, que debemos apoyar especialmente, es también una responsabilidad de la vieja Europa, de la vieja Europa donde nos movemos. Europa y la socialdemocracia europea lideró después de las dos grandes guerras los movimientos de igualdad y los movimientos del Estado para conseguir el Estado de bienestar. Son dos ejes fundamentales. Siempre hemos dicho que no se puede despreciar ni olvidar al 50% de la población, y ese 50% de la población son las mujeres. Nadie, ninguna sociedad inteligente puede prescindir de esa inteligencia, sino a apoyarla y tenerla en consideración e incorporarla en la toma de decisiones. Y, por otro lado, ese movimiento político en el norte del Mediterráneo y en Oriente Medio de reclamación de libertad, de paz y de convivencia. Tenemos que tener en cuenta, aunque sean muy dispares, muy diferentes, las posiciones, la evolución en cada uno de nuestros países, ya se ha dicho aquí, de Túnez, de Egipto, de Siria, de Libia. Algunos de ellos han hecho y han puesto en marcha reformas muy profundas como Marruecos, Jordania, Argelia, que son muy importantes. Pero queda un aspecto al que Tony Joy especialmente se ha referido también antes, que me gustaría resaltar, y es el tema de Palestina. Yo creo que todos hemos conocido cómo estas semanas previas y continuará en esta sesión anual de Naciones Unidas que acaba de abrirse el debate sobre la petición de Palestina para que sea considerado como un Estado observador dentro de Naciones Unidas. Mi país apoya muy decididamente esta decisión porque considera que es un paso importantísimo para llegar a considerar dos cuestiones. Por un lado, que al cabo del tiempo a Palestina pueda ser considerada como un Estado miembro de pleno derecho de Naciones Unidas, pero sobre todo porque consideramos que puede ser un impulso definitivo para que la Autoridad Nacional Palestina inicie de nuevo el proceso de negociaciones para conseguir una paz. Sin paz, sin seguridad, sin reequilibrio económico y sin igualdad, la paz no será estable ni posible, ni la seguridad, por tanto, en este nuevo centro geopolítico del mundo. Gracias.
Gracias, Isabel. Next speaker on my list is Monsieur Michel Billot from France.
Oui, merci, Monsieur le Président, mes chers collègues. Les événements de cette année dans les pays arabes, qu'on les nomme printemps ou révolution, nous rappellent que les conflits de cette région ne pourront trouver de règlement politique sans avancée notable au niveau du premier d'entre eux, le conflit israélo-palestinien. Comme je l'ai dit à Belgrade et comme notre vice-présidente vient d'en faire état, une chance historique se profile, la reconnaissance d'un État palestinien par l'ONU. Celle-ci n'est pas dirigée contre Israël. C'est au contraire faire clairement le pari qu'un nouveau cycle de négociations pour une paix juste, fondée sur le droit international et garantie par le multilatéralisme, s'ouvre enfin. À l'inverse, renvoyer les protagonistes une fois de plus à des négociations bilatérales reviendrait à allonger la longue liste des échecs constatés depuis 20 ans. Ainsi, la poursuite de la colonisation, avec notamment l'annonce de la construction de 1100 nouveaux logements dans une colonie proche de Jérusalem-Est montre bien que le gouvernement israélien n'est pas favorable à la reprise des négociations. Sans langue de bois, il faut bien aussi constater, comme Alain Juppé, ministre des Affaires étrangères français, que l'initiative du quartet n'a pas réussi. Dans ces conditions, en soutenant le gouvernement israélien et en bloquant la demande d'adhésion à l'ONU, les États-Unis prennent le risque de plonger une nouvelle fois la jeunesse palestinienne dans le désespoir. Et surtout, les partisans de la paix négociée en sortiront irrémédiablement affaiblis. Notre Assemblée a sa part de responsabilité. Quel dommage que celle-ci ait rejeté en juillet dernier la proposition de résolution demandant que l'OSCE octroie le statut de partenaire méditerranéen à l'autorité palestinienne. Tout en reconnaissant, il est vrai, dans la résolution concernant la transition politique méditerranéenne, je cite, « l'État d'Israël est un État palestinien indépendant, démocratique, souverain et viable, vivant dans la paix et la sécurité et s'acceptant mutuellement ». Fin de citation, il y a là un paradoxe qui devrait nous interpeller. De nombreuses organisations internationales ont reconnu dans les dernières semaines que toutes les conditions techniques étaient désormais réunies pour permettre la création d'un État palestinien viable, ayant tous les attributs de la souveraineté. Mercredi dernier, le Conseil exécutif à l'UNESCO a voté à une très large majorité un texte recommandant l'admission pleine et entière de la Palestine à cette organisation des Nations Unies. Il faudra donc franchir le pas aussi dans notre organisation en cette période historique pour les peuples de la Méditerranée. Une dynamique est née, mais son issue est incertaine. Nous pouvons l'aider à réussir. Je vous remercie de votre attention.
Merci, monsieur. Now I'm calling Mr. Matteo Mecacci, chairman of the third committee, to address us. Matteo, you've got the floor.
Sì, grazie, Presidente. Siccome non sono molte le occasioni in cui abbiamo l'opportunità di parlare con i nostri colleghi e amici del mondo arabo, io credo si debba farlo cercando di essere il più vicini possibile al linguaggio della verità. E per quel che mi riguarda, io credo che le cose che anche tu, Presidente, hai detto stamani insieme ad altri sullo shock che le rivoluzioni del mondo arabo hanno determinato, questo va detto, non è stato uno shock solo per i Gheddafi, per i Ben Ali, per i Mubarak o per gli Assad. Diciamo che è stato uno shock anche per molti dei nostri governanti, perché molte delle politiche dell'Occidente in questi decenni sono state anche politiche di sostegno a quei regimi che hanno prodotto stagnazione economica, che hanno prodotto crisi sociali e che hanno prodotto mancanza di libertà. Quindi se dobbiamo andare avanti credo che si debba capire se riusciamo ad imparare dagli errori che sono stati fatti in passato. E ho l'impressione che ancora si sia un po' lontani, perché quando si sostengono le dittature negli altri paesi non ci se ne rende conto, ma si inizia ad uccidere la democrazia anche nei nostri paesi. E questo credo si debba riconoscerlo. Ora, io credo che quello che è accaduto nel mondo arabo e le conseguenze che si stanno avendo in Europa purtroppo sta avendo una risposta politica europea inadeguata. Le divisioni stanno aumentando. Abbiamo avuto nel nostro paese, in Italia, alcune decine di migliaia di immigrati tunisini che sono giunti dalla Libia e l'effetto di alcune decine di migliaia di persone arrivate in un continente di 500 milioni di persone è stato mettere in discussione Trattato di Schengen, lotta diplomatica tra Francia, Italia, altri paesi nel nord Europa stanno parlando della sospensione del Trattato di Schengen. Abbiamo sentito l'ambasciatore tunisino che ci ha detto che la Tunisia, un paese di pochi milioni di persone, ha accolto 900.000 rifugiati dalla Libia. Mentre noi in Europa stiamo adesso discutendo di sospendere il Trattato di Schengen perché ci sono alcune migliaia di cittadini che da questa regione, dai Balcani occidentali, giungono in Europa e chiedono asilo politico. Allora, se si tratta di intervenire in una regione, lo si può fare se si ha chiari quali sono gli obiettivi e se ha la capacità di esercitare una leadership politica. E credo che in un momento di crisi, in un momento di profonde divisioni che riguardano queste questioni, ma sappiamo benissimo nei nostri paesi qual è il dibattito sulla crisi economica, la necessità di intervenire con le istituzioni europee per salvaguardare l'area dell'euro e tutte le cose che conosciamo, non è il tempo del riemergere delle divisioni e degli approcci nazionalistici. In un'organizzazione in particolare come l'OSCE, che è fondata sul consenso dei paesi membri, le divisioni nazionali portano alla irrilevanza di questa organizzazione, al fallimento di quelli che sono i suoi obiettivi. L'abbiamo visto, purtroppo anche il nostro segretario generale ce l'ha ricordato stamattina, nei momenti di crisi in Georgia chiude la missione OSCE, nel momento di crisi in Bielorussia chiude la missione OSCE. Credo non si possa andare avanti così e credo che quello che ci è venuto oggi dai nostri partner dei paesi arabi è stata chiaramente una richiesta di collaborazione politica. Credo che si debba avere la capacità di dargli seguito al massimo livello governativo, dalla chairmanship lituana, da chi sta coordinando il lavoro sul Mediterraneo, perché ci sono i margini per farlo e per farlo nel modo giusto, perché se solo sapremo mostrare ai nostri cittadini che vogliamo costruire un futuro migliore non solo per noi stessi in modo un po' egoistico, ma anche per coloro che ai nostri confini cercano quegli stessi valori sui quali si è fondata l'Europa e si è fondata l'OSCE, sapremo garantirci il futuro. Se no, credo che non ce la faremo nessuno di noi all'interno dei nostri territori e dei nostri confini nazionali, che non sono ormai in un mondo così globalizzato sicuri, se non si riesce a collaborare con chi ci è vicino. Credo che sia la cosa giusta da fare e credo che ci siano anche le risorse nella nostra assemblea parlamentare per dare questa spinta politica in questa direzione.
Grazie Matteo. The next speaker is Madam Hedy Fry, our special representative on gender issues from Canada.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chair. I wanted to take this opportunity, before I say anything, to thank the Croatian delegation here and the government for what was a most efficient, hospitable, and beautiful experience. I think that the efficiency was something that I noted from the very beginning. The fact that we could eat lunch without having to line up for too long was a really important part of that. I wanted to speak a little bit about the fact that we talk about whether the OSCE has a role to play in this, because some of the nations that have participated in the Arab Spring are not necessarily members of the OSCE. But I think the OSCPA has a greater role to play, and we have a moral obligation to play that role. I think I just heard my colleague, Mr. McCatchy, talk a little bit about substantive aid in terms of looking at displaced persons and seeing how we could help with that without turning our backs on it and becoming xenophobic about that. We can, on the one hand, admire the Arab Spring and speak to what it meant and to the freedoms and the hope that it gave to a whole region. We also have to participate by lending a hand where needed. But I wanted to talk a little bit about the fact that some parliamentarians are already playing a role, and some of the members of the OSCE are already playing a role. Canada, for instance, has played a large role in Libya. We have a strong presence there, and in fact, our parliament recently voted to extend our presence there with NATO in Libya, under the heading, of course, of responsibility to protect civilians, and I think that was why we were there. However, I think we need to talk about further what happens after the spring, what happens after the revolution, what happens after governments have been ousted. I think we need to be able, as OSCEPA, to play a role at looking at stability in the region. We need to be vigilant. Regional stability is going to be very, very important. And we need to be able to note whether, in fact, regimes that are replacing the old regimes are committed clearly to democracy and to ensure that, in fact, there is no exploitation of what, in essence, is a movement to democracy and freedom, that there isn't exploitation by others of that gap that is there, of the fragility that is there at the moment. And I think that we need to look at how we can stop that exploitation by offering developmental aid. I think that was one of the big pieces that we have to be able to do. And I think we need to support, I know that Canada has been very vocal in support of the National Transition Council that we heard Madame Ferrier speak about when she spoke to the fact that women want to be a full player in that. And I think finally I want to say that the gender is an important issue here. Because the women of these regions were repressed. They stood up. They were part of that voice, of that revolution, of that speaking out. And now they want to be there for the rebuilding. In many ways, women who have been victims of conflict and victims of war understand how to rebuild after war and after conflict. And the role of women in this rebuilding is extremely important at the highest levels, at economic, social levels, and at building democratic institutions level, because I think women are very well aware that, in fact, they will be more vigilant than anyone to ensure that we do not have regimes that are committed to ideology and fundamentalism. And I just wanted to mention that as a way of putting forward what Canada thinks in some place, some ways, and what OSCPA can do in terms of support, vigilance, and real concrete action in terms of assisting displaced persons. Thank you very much.
Many thanks for your contribution, Madam Fry. Now it's time for Madam Marion Kindle-Kinis from Liechtenstein.
Danke, Herr Vorsitzender, werte Kolleginnen, werte Kollegen. Die Veränderungen, welche in der arabischen Welt vor sich gingen und immer noch andauern, sind aus demokratischer Sicht sehr zu begrüßen und unterstützenswert. Wir dürfen jedoch nicht vergessen, dass der demokratische Prozess nach den Umstürzen oder gar nach den ersten demokratischen Wahlen nicht abgeschlossen ist. Es handelt sich nämlich um einen langen und unter Umständen auch einen beschwerlichen Weg, welcher aber unumgänglich ist. Viele Redner haben bereits auf einige demokratische Rechte wie freie Wahlen, Meinungsfreiheit etc. hingewiesen. Was aber vor allem zu einer Demokratie gehört, ist die Respektierung der Frauen und ihrer Rechte. Ich unterstütze die gerade von meiner kanadischen Kollegin angesprochenen Worte und auch meiner spanischen Kollegin, dass wir die Frauen in diesen Ländern unterstützen müssen, denn es waren sie, die im arabischen Frühling eine herausragende Rolle gespielt haben und immer noch spielen. Ich appelliere deshalb an alle sich in Umwandlung befindlichen Ländern, Frauen als gleichberechtigte Partner zu sehen und ihnen die Rechte einzuräumen, welche es zur Ausübung der Demokratie benötigt. Ohne die Anerkennung der Frauen als gleichberechtigte Partner kann Demokratie nicht gelingen. Danke.
Danke schön. I'm inviting Mr. Emin Onen from Turkey to speak.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Today there are so many valuable and constructive speeches made by our colleagues. First of all, I want to thank them for their contributions. And first of all, it's a very important issue that the Middle East and the North African region has arrived at a defining irreversible turning point. Change and democratic transformation are inevitable for all regional countries in one way or another. We apply a principled stance regarding the popular movements in the Middle East, North Africa region. We emphasize the following points in order to ensure that the process of change takes place in orderly manner, sustainable security and stability in only possible through meeting the legitimate aspirations of the people. Thus, we strongly encourage our regional partners to announce and implement comprehensive reforms in due course. We are ready to extend all necessary support towards this end. Violence and disproportionate use of force is unacceptable. Sovereignty, independence, territorial integrity, and political unity of each country have to be preserved and respected. Transformation should be led and owned by the respective peoples themselves. we should not let this process be hijacked by radicals who seek something sectarian, ethnic, or ideological strife across the region. We are ready to enhance our bilateral consultations and coordination in a structural framework in light of the historic developments in the region. We should work together to extend our support to the Middle East, North African countries in the need of technical assistance. And finally, making the Mediterranean a safer place, we all must help carrying to this area the seeds of freedom, security, and justice. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you for your contribution, Mr. Ronen. And now time has come for Mr. Eric Raoult to speak from France. Please, sir.
Merci, Monsieur le Président de séance. J'interviendrai pour donner une tonalité complémentaire de celle de mon collègue qui est intervenu tout à l'heure. Comme beaucoup ici, j'ai été étonné, stupéfait de ce qui s'est passé dans le Maghreb, mais peut-être contrairement à un certain nombre d'intervenants, je suis conservateur, donc je ne suis pas dans une réunion de l'internationale socialiste ou social-démocrate, je suis optimiste, mais je suis aussi réaliste. Pourquoi ? Tout simplement parce que quand nous étions ici, à Dubrovnik, à Tunis, on a incendié une télévision privée. Je suis optimiste mais réaliste parce que j'ai vu, venant d'Égypte, des images que nous ne tolérerions pas dans nos démocraties. Un ancien chef d'État amené sur un lit d'hôpital derrière des barreaux. Et puis j'ai vu aussi les images qui étaient celles de l'ambassade d'Israël incendiée. Et je me suis étonné qu'il n'y ait pas beaucoup de réactions, parce que ce n'est pas un moyen de dialogue que d'incendier une ambassade. Et puis je vais vous faire une confidence. J'ai beaucoup d'amis à Djerba, en Tunisie. Et pour deux d'entre eux, je leur ai envoyé un message de bonne année en leur disant en français « Shana Tova ». L'un m'a dit « La fois prochaine, fais attention, parle-moi en anglais ». Il faut voir que dans ces pays qui ont retrouvé la liberté, nous devons être présents, mais conscients. Je ne veux pas être celui qui aura applaudi des gens qui jettent des pierres à des homosexuels, des gens qui violent des femmes parce qu'elles participaient aux réunions des partis politiques qui pouvaient soutenir le président Kadhafi ou le président Ben Ali. Ce qui s'est passé dans le Maghreb a montré que ceux qui tiennent, c'est ceux qui sont intelligents et qui reposent leur pouvoir sur des nations plus que sur des hommes. Et donc, ce réalisme, je souhaite l'avoir avec les valeurs qui sont celles de mon pays par rapport à tout risque de dérive. Il faut donc avoir un bonheur, mais un bonheur vigilant. D'autre part, je voudrais dire aussi à mes différents collègues, M. Tony Lloyd, mon collègue Bayou, qui sont intervenus sur le conflit israélo-palestinien, c'est qu'ils n'ont peut-être pris, enfin du moins je parle pour la diplomatie française, pas pour la diplomatie britannique, qu'une partie de la diversité de notre pays. Notre pays, la France, et je pense que l'Europe a pris à peu près la même situation, la même position, est favorable à un État palestinien, mais à la réaffirmation de l'État israélien. Je suis, chers collègues, le député d'un département qui s'appelle la Seine-Saint-Denis, où nous avons une commune qui s'appelle Drancy. Il y a beaucoup de Juifs qui sont arrivés à Drancy, mais ils n'en sont pas revenus. Et donc, en fonction de cela, lorsque je parle d'Israël, j'ai ce souvenir-là, et parmi ceux qui ne sont pas revenus, il y avait plusieurs membres de ma famille. Voilà, chers collègues, ce que je voulais dire pour que l'OSCE, qui compte des députés sociaux-démocrates, mais des députés conservateurs, puisse avoir une position équilibrée.
Merci, monsieur. Now I'm inviting a representative from delegation for Malta to speak to us.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Colleagues, before passing some comments on the subject, I would like to join those who congratulated the Croatian delegation for their organization and hospitality. Now, let me pass some comments on the subject. Of course, Mr. Chairman, I think that these are interesting times also for the OSCE in the development of this organization. As things are developing, I think even the OSCE will have to develop according to the new developments that are happening in the Mediterranean, especially in the northern part of Africa. If we go back some years, I think we can also mention a number of other initiatives that took place. For example, the Barcelona process, which started in 1995 with its three pillars and the political, economical, and social dimension of that initiative. Looking back, I think we have to ask the question whether this initiative was successful in spite of all the good intentions. I think that now we can say that we did not achieve what we wanted. My country, Malta, has been always a prime mover in Mediterranean affairs, and I would like to mention the Parliamentary Assembly for the Mediterranean, which is a recent development, and it's the cooperation between among parliamentarians of all the Mediterranean region. We have also to would like to mention now that even in the recent developments that are happening in North Africa, especially the neighboring country of Libya, Malta is giving and it's helping the to diminish at least the burden of the people from what is happening in their country. And I think this was also recognized by many countries around the world of this contribution that my country is giving. I think there are some countries, especially those who don't feel that they belong to the Mediterranean region, especially though they see themselves far from this region, that really don't consider or understand as much as they should be, I think, that there is no peace and security in Europe unless there is peace and security in the Mediterranean. By saying this, I am echoing a former Prime Minister of Malta when in Helsinki in 1975, he managed to insert this statement in the final declaration. Mr. Chairman, we have to ask the question, how long we have to wait to adopt a two-state solution for the Israel and Palestinian issue? We are waiting for too long, I think. Of course, Malta is happy to see new democracies emerge after the recent resurgence by the people of some countries in the Mediterranean. However, I share also the comments by the Algerian member when he mentioned Libya, and that maybe it's too early to speak about what's going to happen in Libya and the future of this country. I think that still there is a long way to go, therefore, for the Mediterranean, although we have to say that the process started and we need to help this process along the way. So all of us have to be convinced about the importance of Mediterranean and the issue of stability and security in the Mediterranean. And therefore, I conclude by saying that I'm glad that the OSCE is giving its due importance to the Mediterranean issue. And of course, Malta commends these and similar initiatives, which we always helped and will always try to achieve what we all want, peace and security, not only in the Mediterranean, but also in the whole world. Thanks for your attention.
Thank you for your contribution. Dear colleagues, we are 25 minutes away to conclude this Mediterranean Forum, and we got 5 speakers. Please, I strongly advise you to stick with the 3-minute limitation in order to save some time for our panelists to comment what they have heard. Please, once again, 3 minutes, not more. Now it's time for our colleagues from Netherlands, Mr. Wim Korteven, please.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm addressing this meeting on behalf of the Dutch Party for Freedom. As we speak, the peace in the Mediterranean is being threatened by Turkey's imperialism, by dangerous dreams to re-establish the Turkish caliphate that was abolished in 1923. We are witnessing the death of Kemalism, the positive ideology that transformed Turkey into a valuable, responsible, and respected member of the international community. But now Turkey is sliding into the abyss of Islamic extremism and authoritarianism. This is visible on the inside and on the outside. For instance, the freedom of speech in Turkey is increasingly suppressed. Many journalists have been jailed for speaking out. The Turkish cartoonist Bahadir Baruter is to be tried for renouncing Allah in a cartoon. He might get a year in jail for that. Cyprus, a member state of the European Union, has been partly occupied by Turkey since the brutal invasion of 1974. And now the Erdogan regime is turning Turkey into a predator state, a rogue state, that apparently also wants to seize the oil and gas reserves in the Eastern Mediterranean, reserves that it does not own. Threats are being issued in the direction of Cyprus. Strong Turkish military forces have been deployed on and near Cyprus. Mr. Chairman, Turkey, a member state of NATO, is also increasingly belligerent towards the Jewish state of Israel. Threats and baseless accusations are issued against Israel ever more frequently. And provocations are rampant. Israeli freighters are harassed by Turkish warships. Turkey also objects to Israel's legitimate desire to drill for natural gas in its own exclusive economic zone. Turkey's warships are backing up threats against Israel's sovereignty. A simple mistake in this combustible situation might spark a military confrontation. Also troublesome and dangerous are Turkey's sympathy for the Hamas terror organization and Turkey's attempts to undermine Israel's legitimate right to supervise the maritime routes to Gaza. Mr. Chairman, the situation is extremely dangerous. This irresponsible Turkish policy of threats, insults, and provocations, this macho belligerency, needs to be urgently addressed, as it is a clear and present danger to peace and security in the Mediterranean and even beyond. Therefore, I urge you to add this Turkish threat to peace and security to the agenda of the winter session of the OSCE. Thank you.
I'm now giving the floor to Mr. Ucek Libor. He is a Vice President of European Parliament. Please, 3 times, sir. 3 minutes, sir.
Yes, of course. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Let me to congratulate first of all to your President, Mr. Eftimiou, and to your Assembly for organizing this Mediterranean Forum, because I think it's timely and, of course, it's appropriate. The members of the OSCE went in the last 20, 25 years through tremendous changes. Member states went through the transformations from authoritarian and totalitarian states to democratic ones. And it is the OSCE, the Parliamentary Assembly, that can bring this full bag of knowledge, know-how, good examples, or some examples where the member states made mistake to our friends in Northern Africa and in Arab countries. So when you talk about the role of the OSCE, I'm convinced, as a member of the European Parliament, Vice President of the European Parliament, that yes, there is a role for the OSCE Parliamentary Assembly to play in North Africa. And again, together, we will participate on some of our missions. When I see our Tunisian friends, we will together participate on the election observation mission. And if we will be invited by our Algerian friends or Moroccan friends or Egypt, we will do the same. The transformation, the way towards more freedom, more democracy, more stability, more security, it won't be an easy one. Our Arab and North African friends need help from all of our organizations. In the European Union, as you know, we developed concept of the neighborhood policy. For us, both it's important, the eastern dimension, which we talked about yesterday, and of course, the southern dimension. So we are not forgetting you. We will be working very hard, very closely, also that together we can help you, and then you can achieve your goals, more freedom, more democracy, more stability. Last word, Our Tunisian, Algerian and other colleagues, of course, mentioned the economic situation. It is also very important because we can build more freedom, more democracy, more stability only when we succeed economically. Tunisia, Egypt, Algeria, Morocco, all these our neighbors in southern Mediterranean lost huge amount of money this year as a loss from the tourism income. So we have to take this into account and look not only at the issues which are connected with freedom, security, but also to look at how to help economically and how to build together, if possible, common economic space where we have more trade, more investment, and that will bring, of course, more stability, security, and human and civic rights. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rucek. Thank you for your contribution as well, bridging space between our two organizations. Thank you once again. Now it's time for Mr. Mauro Del Vecchio from Italy, please.
Grazie, signor Presidente. Gli eventi della primavera araba hanno evidenziato la necessità di un ruolo più incisivo dell'OSCE in quell'area. Lo hanno ricordato tutti i relatori e tutti gli interventi di coloro che mi hanno preceduto. Un ruolo che si rivolga non solo al superamento delle crisi, specialmente in quei paesi in cui le crisi sono ancora vive, ma si traduca anche nell'aiuto e nel sostegno in tutto quello che accompagna questi processi di crescita sociale e democratica. Penso alle consultazioni elettorali, allo sviluppo dei partiti politici, penso alla realizzazione di riforme con standard di democrazia e di rispetto dei diritti umani, penso alla promozione delle libertà e dei media, ma penso anche e soprattutto alle politiche migratorie, perché poco fa il capo della delegazione tunisina ci ha ricordato una situazione drammatica che forse molti di noi avevano dimenticato. Condivido appieno quanto il nostro presidente Eftamiu ha sottolineato nel suo intervento di apertura. Dopo aver curato i processi democratici da est ad ovest nell'area di suo interesse, l'OSCE deve ora rivolgere la sua cura principale verso sud, verso l'area del Mediterraneo che è diventata centrale per la sicurezza e la cooperazione in Europa. L'OSCE ha già operato in gran parte per raggiungere questo obiettivo. Oltre al gruppo di contatto con i paesi mediterranei di cui qui abbiamo il Presidente, proprio questa Assemblea, nella riunione invernale di Vienna del corrente anno, ha approvato all'unanimità una dichiarazione di sostegno dei processi democratici della primavera araba. Ma questo non basta. Si tratta ora di promuovere nuove iniziative politiche a favore dei paesi del Nord Africa e della Mezzaluna Fertile, specie dove i processi democratici sono ancora contrastati violentemente. Qui non posso non sottolineare anch'io che sussiste e permane veramente pesante la situazione palestinese. Si tratta ancora di mettere in campo misure di aiuto come quelle individuate dal segretario generale dell'organizzazione, di investire risorse di personale e finanziarie, di far conoscere alle popolazioni di quell'area i compiti dell'OSCE ed appena possibile di coinvolgere tutti i paesi del Nord Africa in forme di associazione ed integrazione con la nostra organizzazione quanto più forti possibili. Credo che questa correzione della centralità geopolitica delle azioni dell'OSCE, perché di questo si tratta, possa contribuire fortemente al prestigio e all'efficacia della nostra organizzazione e possa soprattutto confermare la capacità, quello noi vogliamo, dei nostri paesi di interpretare al meglio i fenomeni storici che ci coinvolgono. Grazie.
Grazie a lei. Signore Del Vecchio, and I need to inform you that last three speakers on my list are victims of circumstances, and I can offer them only 2 minutes each. First is Mr. Mohamed Naib Boulif from Morocco.
Merci, Monsieur le Président, chers collègues. Notre forum méditerranéen se réunit sur le thème « Liberté, sécurité et justice ». Comme vous le savez, au Sud, certains peuples ont pu franchir les premiers pas, et je dis bien les premiers pas vers la liberté. Ce qui veut dire qu'il ne faut pas déjà crier victoire. La liberté, c'est un long processus, c'est un processus dans la durée, mais aussi dans la continuité. Certains de ces pays l'ont fait à travers, effectivement, des révoltes, mais d'autres, comme le Maroc, le font à travers les institutions. Je ne reviendrai pas sur ce que mes collègues marocains ont dit sur le processus marocain. Pour ce qui est de la justice, je dirais qu'un long chemin reste encore à parcourir pour l'ensemble des pays du Sud. Justice entre les populations, riches et pauvres, justice aussi entre les régions, il y a aussi de grandes largesses entre les différentes régions, mais aussi justice entre les sexes, entre les femmes et les hommes. Justice qui doit effectivement être vue dans sa valeur universelle, puisque comme vous le savez, et fort malheureusement, nos amis partenaires du Nord ont bien, à un certain moment, supporté un certain nombre de régimes, et ces régimes, effectivement, ont basculé, et c'est là un des éléments de l'injustice que nous souhaitons ne se répétera pas dans l'avenir. Il faut toujours se mettre du côté des peuples arabes, et non pas du côté de ceux qui les détiennent, et surtout s'ils sont des dictateurs. Pour ce qui est de la sécurité, cher Président, il y a encore plusieurs sujets qui nuisent encore à sa parfaite et à sa pleine réalisation. Je ne citerai que la migration clandestine, le terrorisme, la drogue et la corruption transnationale, mais aussi l'armement actuellement du peuple libyen. Et je citerai là aussi la grande question centrale du Moyen-Orient. Je ne reviendrai pas sur les propos tenus par nos chers amis et collègues, d'abord notre collègue de l'Espagne, mais aussi notre collègue de la France et surtout le premier député concernant l'État palestinien. Mais j'ajouterai que nous, en tant que parlementaires, il faudrait quand même rendre hommage à un certain nombre de parlementaires palestiniens qui croulent encore dans les prisons israéliennes après plus de 3 années de maintenant. Donc avec ces 3 grands thèmes, peuvent-ils, donc liberté, justice et sécurité, peuvent-ils être réglés avec d'un côté des pays membres à plein entière, mais aussi d'autres, des pays qui sont des pays partenaires à un deuxième degré. Nous pensons au Royaume du Maroc qu'une nouvelle étape de partenariat doit être franchie pour permettre l'épanouissement des uns et des autres. Et je ne reviendrai pas sur l'illustre propos du président Migliori de l'Italie qui a parlé d'un déplacement des frontières démocratiques et non pas les frontières qui
restent quand même.
Qui reste quand même géographique. Donc, trois propositions, Monsieur le Président, rapidement. J'avais d'autres propos, mais là, je résume. Nous pensons qu'il faudrait quand même nouer un certain nombre de relations bilatérales, et je dis bien bilatérales, entre l'OCE, pour sensibiliser les pays de la rive sud méditerranéenne, pour se mettre d'accord sur une feuille de route, et donc un certain nombre d'engagements à respecter de part et d'autre. Deuxième proposition, il faudrait quand même que de chaque session annuelle de l'été, il faut avoir des comptes rendus permanents dans cette réunion pour suivre l'état d'avancement des réformes entretenues par les pays de la Méditerranée. Et troisièmement, pourquoi pas prévoir une réunion de l'Assemblée parlementaire de l'OCE dans un pays partenaire au cours de 2012. Merci, Monsieur le Président.
Merci. Mr. Emin Onen from Turkey again. Sir, you got the floor.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chair. I don't want to give any response from the Netherlands, but I want to clarify something else that everybody should know. This is a very unlucky speech, I think, that gives harm all today's separate and constructive speech. Because Turkey and Israel, Turkey and Cyprus, have a fragile. Now, today the issues between the two countries are very fragile. So there is a member of the Cyprus, and there is also the representative from the Israel. There is an ambassador here. They are talking a constructive way of their speech that because of the two countries have last times that we have some issues. So I condemn him because he talked against the peace. So maybe everybody, if watch their language under the OSCE's umbrella, I think we have more opportunities to give and enhance the peace and the other issues between the countries. And I just want to say about the Israel issue between Turkey. and Israel. In the flotilla, which have 8 convoys to the Gaza, there is no weapon in that flotilla, and there are 9 persons died in that flotilla, and most of them died in a very close range. They shot their heads, and most of them shot there in the back. So this is not a self-defense, this is an execution. But again, we have so many problems, but we want to solve this with the peaceful and negotiable way. This typing of talking just gives harms. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir, for your intervention. And finally, 2 minutes for
Mr. Senatore Chairman, a point Randazzo. Of order. Point of order, please.
Oh, yes. Please.
Mr. Chairman, because our colleague from Turkey said the Netherlands, as head of the Dutch delegation, there is good to make a clarification. My colleague didn't speak on behalf of the Dutch delegation, but on behalf of his own party, the Freedom Party. So we are speaking today on an important issue of the Arabic Spring, there where we can welcome democratic developments, and one of the democratic developments is also respect to other countries. And I'm totally not, and my other colleagues are totally not agree with the input of my colleague, but as we have democratic rules also in this room, we allow our colleague to speak free out. But we don't allow in that sense that other countries or persons are treated in this way. So let me clear on that way that we speak with respect to each other. Maybe we can disagree on dossiers, but respect and tolerance is a main issue and an important issue. Thank you.
Your clarification was needed and reasonable. As I said, 2 minutes for Senatore Nino Randazzo. 2 minutes. Sir, floor is yours.
Grazie, Presidente. Direi che c'è da rallegrarsi, da congratularsi per la prima apertura, per il primo esempio di collaborazione diretta dell'OSCE con un paese partner del continente africano, in concomitanza con la fase iniziale della cosiddetta, e bene a ragione, primavera araba, cioè l'invito all'OSCE di partecipare alla missione internazionale di monitoraggio delle imminenti elezioni in Tunisia. Questo particolare sviluppo della situazione nel contesto del partenariato viene a premiare la visione e la lungimiranza che a suo tempo dettò alla nostra organizzazione la costituzione del Foro Mediterraneo. Pertanto, desidero in questa occasione richiamare l'attenzione su un particolare aspetto, l'hanno fatto anche altri miei colleghi oggi, un particolare aspetto del nostro solito approccio alla dimensione mediterranea dell'OSCE. Per carità, ne parliamo all'occasione con un certo entusiasmo, ne riconosciamo l'importanza e la validità, ma trascuriamo, si direbbe sistematicamente, quando addirittura non lo neghiamo del tutto, non lo dimentichiamo del tutto, trascuriamo un elemento, uno spazio dove l'OSCE potrebbe ritagliarsi un forte ruolo consultivo e propositivo. Trascuriamo l'elemento di maggiore conflittualità nel tormentato scacchiere medio orientale, un elemento che è di rilevanza cruciale anche per la sicurezza e gli interessi di tanta parte dell'Europa. Mi riferisco, come hanno fatto altri miei colleghi, al nodo palestinese, la questione vitale di almeno 12 milioni di esseri umani sparsi in un'immensa diaspora planetaria forzata, fra cui 5 milioni di apolidi privi di elementari diritti civili, adattatisi a condizioni subumane in squallidi campi profughi. Certamente è una questione esplosiva, resta ancora più delicata e controversa per i giochi di potere e veti incrociati del famoso, o famigerato come qualcuno sostiene, quartetto ONU, Unione Europea, Stati Uniti e Russia, che bloccano proprio in questi giorni una minima, semplicissima, più che ragionevole richiesta dell'autorità nazionale palestinese dello status di quo alle Nazioni Unite. Situazione esplosiva quanto vogliamo, ma di che cosa l'OSCE ha paura ad affrontare? C'è tutta un'ampia base di pareri e incoraggiamenti dei più autorevoli organismi internazionali per spingere anche l'OSCE a tentare, almeno tentare, di dare un contributo al rasserenamento delle tensioni in atto. Già gli accordi di Oslo del 1993 parlavano esplicitamente dei legittimi diritti del popolo palestinese all'autodeterminazione. Oggi ben 122...
Senatore, time is over.
Sì, concludo. Riconoscono con formali dichiarazioni l'esistenza di una nazione palestinese. Ora dico, se non ci focalizziamo maggiormente su questo tema veramente esplosivo, io credo che l'OSCE, o almeno il Foro Mediterraneo dell'OSCE, rischia di perdere tempo e credibilità. Grazie.
Grazie a lei, signore. Sorry, we exhausted time, but of course we did not exhaust all the open dilemmas we opened today during debate. I would like to thank everybody who took a part in our discussion, but it would be unfair to leave this room and not giving a chance for our panelists to comment at least with 1 or 1.5 minutes what they just have heard. So I will start with, of course, Lambetta Zanier, our Secretary General. Please, sir.
Thank you. I will be extremely quick. I would make 3 points. First, I heard from, I think, the Algerian representative a reference to the fact that he had nothing, that Algeria has nothing against control and surveillance, as he said, control and surveillance on the side of international organizations. That's not really the way we are seeing this process. There's nothing to control and there's no surveillance you want to carry out. What we're talking about is assistance to the extent that this is interested, is helping in capacity building, is sharing best practices, sharing our own model for you to draw what you think is important, including the many times the gender issue and the role of women that has been raised in the course of the discussion. So that's the way we tend to present our capacity to contribute from the OSCE side, certainly not to come and control anything. Second point, the issue of Libya and the role of weapons in the area has come up a number of times. And apart from the fact that there is an issue with the question of Libya versus the OSCE, Libya is not a partner state at this point. But we have quite some interesting experiences in the OSCE area on issues of control of weapons. We have a best practice book on small arms and light weapons, and we have projects that have been carried out on that basis in our field. So feel free to come and see what we are doing. We have experiences of arms control, both Europe-wide and at the sub-regional level, including here in the Balkans, in Bosnia, on CSBMs, and regional arms control, the so-called Article 2, Article 4 negotiations. And the final point, I heard the intervention from a Moroccan representative suggesting that next year, parliamentary assembly meeting could take place parliamentary assembly, I might have missed something, but take place in a partner state. there could be a meeting devoted to Mediterranean issues. I certainly would welcome a stronger ownership by partner states on the southern rim of the Mediterranean of processes of cooperation with the OSCE, so including meetings of the contact group and the Mediterranean Conference. It would be very good if also there periodically our partners would host some of these events. Thank you.
Thank you, Secretary General, Ambassador.
Thank you. Very briefly, just to say that the exhaustive nature of the discussion reflects, I think, the great hope that we all have for arising from developments in the region. While some are more optimistic than others, this is a time of great change, and we in the OSCE will not obviously be a central player in this, but we should do all we can to help. And in that context, we would stress once again that it is a matter for the Mediterranean partner states to avail of our experience, our advice. Secretary General mentioned another few areas. One that the OSCE has been doing a lot of work on is the code of conduct in military issues and democratic control of the armed forces, the whole issue of financial accountability and so on. An awful lot of very good work is there, and it's available to hand. And if that is of interest to any of the partner states, we would dearly be very willing to share it. One other aspect, unfortunately, for the second year running now, we are holding the Mediterranean Conference outside of the Mediterranean partners. We had it last year in Malta, this year in Montenegro. I think this was unavoidable due to logistical and other concerns, but we should, if at all possible, attempt to resume the practice of holding it in one of the partner countries next year. Thank you.
Thank you, Ambassador. Gospodine Matvejeviću, nije lako sažeti utiske nakon ovakve rasprave u minutu dvije, pokušajte.
Ce sont les choses que je répète souvent quand je suis avec les amis arabes. J'ai gardé de l'ex-Yougoslavie toute l'amitié avec les pays arabes où je suis traduit, où je suis très souvent présent. Et je, en critiquant une expérience européenne, je voudrais faire une mise en garde à nos amis arabes. Qu'est-ce que nous avons vu dans l'histoire européenne, nous avons vu un christianisme qui a voulu christianiser la modernité. Et ça s'est terminé, heureusement, par un échec. On ne peut pas... La modernité est plus violente, plus forte, plus résistante. Elle a résisté et le christianisme n'a pas christianisé la modernité. Là, je dis ce que j'avais à dire. Pour ce qui concerne l'islam, je souhaite, et je le dis très souvent à mes amis arabes, mes amis musulmans, croyants ou laïcs, je dis, écoutez, je souhaite que vous ayez la même expérience. L'islamisme ne peut pas islamiser la modernité. La modernité est trop forte. Essayez de ne pas laisser aller en ce sens, non pas la libre profession de l'islam, mais l'islamisme qui voudrait s'imposer à la modernité. Ça peut produire encore des retards. Les retards sont déjà présents. Et donc, cet échec du christianisme devant la modernité, cette modernité qui a résisté au christianisme, je souhaite qu'elle résiste également à l'islamisme.
Zahvaljujem gospodinu Matvejeviću, and I would like to thank to all our panelists for their contribution. And now I would like to our president, Mr. Petros Evtimiou, do both things, to in a way sum up what we heard and speak about last 3 hours, and in a way, of course, to respect agenda and conclude this year for meetings in the city of Dubrovnik, Croatia. Petros, you got the floor.
Thank you. I hope to do it that in 3 minutes. And I want to start with thanks to our interpreters that help us with their excellent job in our difficult job. And please tolerate us for more 3 minutes, because already we are out of your contract. Thank you. Dear colleagues, we are in the middle of a storm of initiatives. We intervene and we do well in Libya under the UN mandate. There are the plans of the new Marshall Plan, let's say, by President Obama, G8, with $55 billion for the reconstruction of the Arab world. There are our plans here in the OEC Parliamentary Assembly, in the OEC, in the European Parliament. We have heard Libo Rucek, the Vice President. There is the Parliamentary Assembly of the Mediterranean having her own plans, the Mediterranean Union in Barcelona. So this indicates that there is this blessed moment in history, as it was in French Revolution, as it was in American Revolution, in our revolutions, national or social revolutions, in all of our countries, when the people is present, when the people change history. It's not because we have been enlightened and we realized what happened to the Arab world, it's because the Arab people imposes to us the dilemma with whom you are. Because I decided for myself to be for democracy, because democracy is the only condition for a human being to have a dignity, to have a right to be a man. That's why those days are for them. And we have to respect them, and we have to serve them, to say we are here and we must be there. Because we all understand that, because as so many described, I remember just the last one, Isabel Pozuelo, we are in the changing world, and Mediterranean is again in the middle of the history. And we have to be enough wise and prudent to work together in the north of Mediterranean, in the south, in the east, in the west, in order to have a new era of stability, of cooperation, of democracy. And believe me, this is not because we are here. I believe that OEC experience is irreplaceable. So it deserves to be there as OEC Parliamentary Assembly, as OEC, as organization. And one last conclusion about us. I hope and I think that our political life in our countries could be better if the performance of the Parliamentary Assembly was the performance of our national parliaments. We have had so fruitful 2 days that sometimes in our states, to have the concentrated result of those 2 days, we need 2 months. So it was a very, very, very successful conference due to the contribution of all of our delegation, of all of our colleagues, but of course because of our Croatian colleagues. The Croatian delegation, headed by Tonino Picula, that provided us this excellent organization. Thank you again. Our next meeting is in Vienna, but some of us, they walk in the desert in Tunisia, some in the north in Kyrgyzstan, and many of us not in the steppes of Russia, I hope, Alexander, but also in the cities of Russia and